passed into a church along the way. Well, I got down on my knees and I began to pray. You know, the preacher likes the cold because we're going to stay California dreaming on such a winter day. But today there's no California dreaming because the winter day is here and it is cold and it is miserable. This has to be like the worst day we've had in California in a long time, actually. It is yikes. Yet the show must go on. So, hey, it's great. Love it. Imagine for one moment, see if you can even conceive of this. If there was someone in the world who, no matter what happened, remained completely blissful and untroubled and happy, no matter what happened. There have been those in the world like that, actually. But when I was trying to conceive of that, thinking, okay, let's see if I can do that, I said, well, wait a minute. No, I can't go around blissful and carefree and happy when there's all these tragedies happening in the world. How can anyone do that? People will say, you're nuts, you're unfeeling, you're uncaring, what's the matter with you? I mean, if you go to a funeral, you're going to be all totally blissful, or just, well, we don't need to use a funeral. I mean, just all the events that take place in the world, there's so much tragedy all the time, horrible stuff. How is that possible? How is that possible? And yet it has happened. And so was meditating on that this morning. Stayed in bed, meditated for a long time, or contemplated, focused. It's a focus, really, really focus. And amazing answers came. Probably the most in-depth focus I've ever had, which is necessary at this time. Now, I've said we need to go beyond words, and here we are with words. But we have to keep the momentum going also. We're not discarding words. We're going beyond them, but they're not discarding them. How is it possible? It is possible. I saw the whole thing, how it's all possible. I'm just waiting for the result. It has to do with, some people call it surrender. What it really is turning your entire perceptual apparatus, the whole mechanism of perception, over to the grace of God, or what's called the Holy Spirit, or whatever you want to call it. So that's called in some traditions surrender, complete surrender. Jesus said, he who would try to save his life would lose it. He who would let go of his life will gain it, which is true. In other words, if you turn over all of existence, all the entire perceptual apparatus, which is for us existence, we experience existence through the perceptual mechanism, through perception. Turn that all over, give it all up, and say, it's not necessary, I don't need it. This whole hypothetical scenario, which uses perception, is completely unnecessary. Be willing to just surrender it, give it all up, don't want it anymore, take it all here, hand it over. That's the way, that is the way. And then, supposedly, that gets what gets given back to us in this purified, beautiful form called the vision of Christ, our bliss, or there are various terminologies for that too. So it hasn't happened for me yet. I tried to turn it all over. I feel like I did. And then I'm searching in my mind. Is there any exception I'm making? Because you can't make any exception. Cannot. And I couldn't find any exception. But then what came up to me was the special relationship, which Jesus focuses on tremendously in A Course in Miracles, the special relationship, what it's how ruinous it is, et cetera, et cetera. And yet he also says you need to heal the special relationship. So if you're not in one, it seems like you need to get in one in order to heal it, et cetera. It's a little confusing, to say the least. But anyway, I was able to look at the special relationship and see it for what it is. And this has never read it anywhere, but for me it just resonated completely. Our desire for a special relationship is the desire to survive annihilation. In other words, what we believe will survive annihilation is quote-unquote specialness. So we practice specialness. What is specialness? Meaning something has more than something else. Something is more valuable than something else. In reality, there's no such thing as specialness. Everything in reality has everything that is of reality. So if reality is going to be annihilated, then the notion we came up with is, well, there's something that is special, which has the capacity, therefore, has the more, some to survive annihilation of reality. So we practice the survival of annihilation by forming what's called special relationships, whether with people, pets, animals, things, places, whatever. The vision of Christ is everything is equal. It's the overlay. I call it the overlay. So I just said, of course, that's it. Of course, that's it. And people want to, and that just, it just laid the whole thing flat. It just flattened the entire thing, just like that, seeing it that way. I said, hey, this is a great way to see it. And it just seemed like its hold on me just poof, just flattened, collapsed. I said, that's all it is. It's again trying to find a way to survive annihilation of reality, which is a total hypothetical scenario. And we'll never be faced with such a problem ever. And we don't need it as a contingency plan because it's never going to happen. We don't need it. The best we can say is a complete whim, which is totally unnecessary whim. And therefore, why should we fear not having that whim? If it's just a whim, why should anyone be compelled to indulge in such a whim? They should not. They should not feel any fear or guilt whatsoever in not in indulging in such a whim. And that's all it is a complete fanciful whim with no basis in fact whatsoever. And so what I'm expecting is perception to come back to me in some format, that the Holy Spirit returns it in a beautiful format. But even then, I don't need that either. I don't feel attached to that either. I feel like I felt I was able to at least have this willingness to just give up all of existence. And it didn't cause me the slightest fear of trouble whatsoever. I didn't feel any tremors of fear at all. None. I said, take it, take all of it. Don't leave me anywhere. I don't want any of it left. And I found myself engaged in this, and then I realized, you know what, this sounds like some of the meditations that some of the spiritual teachers give out. But I was doing it wasn't like I'm consciously trying to meditate. No, it's just a process of focus and will and determination and wanting to be free of suffering that just led to this. But it occurred to me that these types of meditations are very advanced, really. That we get these meditations are given out, and that's like super, super advanced. And no wonder why people have trouble and try to connect with it at some level of belief. We haven't done the preliminary work. That's part of the problem that we face, the West faced going to the East, getting these great gurus, getting help and teachings, etc., meditations. We weren't really prepared for it. Too advanced, really too advanced. The idea of complete surrender, like in other words, whatever thought arises, say, oh, that's only a thought, and then surrender that thought, and just whatever thought comes up, surrender that. That's a very advanced meditation. I believe that some of the spiritual teachers in the East that were giving that out, saying this is the way to do it. Just whatever arises, just say that too is just my imagination. That too is just a thought. Surrender that into the grace of God. Surrender to the grace of God. That is the highest meditation. I mean, that is true meditation. But unless it's meaningful, unless you see the options clearly, it's not meaningful, and you cannot really do it. In order to make a meaningful choice, you have to see the options clearly. And so for me, I'm working on it from standpoint of seeing that this is all a hypothetical scenario. How did the existence arise? What is it really? Now I see the options clearly, so it's meaningful to me. See, before I never did meditation or anything like that because it wasn't meaningful. I said, whatever takes place has to have meaning to me. I can't just do it like a robot. No. So today, this morning, it all had meaning, very clear meaning. I knew exactly what I was doing. And so it just went like incredibly well. But if I were just to sit there and say, okay, this is a thought, okay, surrender this, okay, this is another thought, I surrender that. That's just going through the motions, and it doesn't have the escape velocity behind it. So I know there's a lot of people who got into meditation. I did not. I got into clarification. And from all those who got into meditation, I haven't seen the fruit of it. I really have not seen much fruit. Occasionally, you see some fruit here and there of different types, but I always felt I was falling behind. I wasn't with it. I wasn't on the spiritual path because I was not doing the meditations. But for me, I didn't have the motivation or clarification to do it. It was meaningless. But now, seeing the options clearly, I see a meaningful choice, and it becomes powerful. I'm literally able to easily get to the point of surrendering everything, all perception of anything good, of anything bad. No judgment of what I'm surrendering, the entire thing. I say, Holy Spirit, it's all yours. It's all yours. I don't want it. I don't need it. It's all yours. Everything. Whatever play, however you want to play, if it makes no difference to me, I could care less. It's meaningless to me. It has no meaning. No necessity, zero necessity. So I don't make any judgment or exceptions. So you take everything. If you want it to be fun or great or wonderful or beautiful, whatever, I don't care. It's your thing now. It's yours. And I hand it over to you, all of it. And even if you return to me in beautiful form, I'm not even interested in that either. But I'll probably take note of it. But it's still not mine. It's not mine. It's all perception now is the Holy Spirit, is how I look at it. Of anything. All success, all failure, the entirety of existence, hand it over to the Holy Spirit. It's all yours, I say. Of course, in order to hand something over, someone has to take it, right? It takes two to tango in that way. So if I'm holding it here, take it, no one takes it, I'm still stuck with it. So I keep saying, take it, take it, take it, come on. Now supposedly, when the offer is genuine, the Holy Spirit is supposed to take it. So far, I haven't felt that it's taken it, but I also realize that I'm expecting it to maybe grab it and suddenly release. Maybe that's not the way it does it. Maybe it takes it so gently you don't even realize it's taken it. That's possible. That's more likely, actually, that I'm not even aware that it's been taken. I offered it up this morning. I offered it all up. No exceptions. I didn't feel any exceptions or any regrets or anything like that. No. Just said, here you go. I don't need it. What do I need it for? Don't need it at all. You do it all the problems. If you want the glory, you take the glory. I don't want any glory. Take all the glory. I don't want to be... It's all success is yours. All glory is yours. Whatever you want to do with existence is fine. But I know it's all completely unnecessary. So it doesn't have any relationship to me whatsoever. None. So then whatever play takes place, it's not my play. It's the Holy Spirit's play. Whatever. That's why gurus, they say, it's not me. Ananda Mahima said, it's not me. I'm not doing anything. She said, I'm not doing anything. It's all the play of God's grace is taking place. She said, I'm just sitting here abiding in the one totality. I'm not going anywhere. I'm not doing anything. She just like watching a movie, but was not doing it. So that's actually the fact. It's the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, that does everything. You turn it over and it's supposed to do everything. It's its game now. It's its play. And I understand that very clearly, that's the right thing to do. And then there's some explanation that can be given out about that for those who, you know, who need the clarification, isn't it? But I won't do that right this moment. So I'm just waiting to see how's the movie go now? I don't know. But it would seem that there should be some indication that it's been taken, you know, that the willingness to give has been accepted, that this exchange has been accepted. And so far I haven't felt anything, which is par for the course, because I've never felt anything from anything I've ever done as far as, do I feel I've made any progress? I've never felt anything. But the fact I was able to get to this point and offer it all up without any problem and see the meaning of it all, et cetera, me, I must have gotten somewhere. I don't know. I was willing to exchange time for eternity. Absolutely. And I was reading in A Course in Miracles yesterday, Jesus said, that's the final step. The final step. When you're willing to do that, then you're there. You are there. And I was willing to do that. It was no problem at all for me. No problem at all. Didn't feel any nervousness or trepidation or difficulty or anything like that. I just said, hey, go ahead, take it. It's like turning over nothing. That's how I felt. You want time and everything in time and space and all situations, all relationships, everything here. Take it. It's yours. I don't want any of it. Not even interested in any of it. None of it. So supposedly that's the final step. So I feel like I've done it. I've done taken the final step, and yet there hasn't been any results that I can. I'm not aware of any results whatsoever at this point. But maybe they'll come. Maybe they'll come. That's possible. That's possible. If they do come, that would be a big boost for sure. But I've given up trying to predict results on the path because I've never been able to predict results. Never. I always feel like I'm going to get results because I always feel like I truly have been willing to made a lot of progress and I've never gotten any results except that greater clarification comes. That's the only results I've ever gotten is greater clarification comes. But as far as how I feel, nothing's ever changed, really. I mean, anxiety has diminished. Fear has diminished. I'm still nervous, of course, and fearful, stressful about just my future, of course. Because right now, based on extrapolating my situation, I have a right to be very nervous about it. So it needs to certainly take on a better format, that is for sure. But again, that's not my thing. I think I have to surrender all perception of all situations, perception of situations and things, time and space and everything that arises in time and space. Surrender the entire perceptual mechanism because I don't need to see it any which way at all. Don't need to even perceive it at all. Don't need to see it in any particular way. It's totally unnecessary. Don't need to see any success. Don't need to see any failure. It's all just simply a hypothetical scenario, a contingency plan, which is totally unnecessary. That's all existence is to me. A contingency plan, which is entirely unnecessary. It will always be entirely unnecessary. It has zero relevance to reality. Zero relevance to what I am. Never will have any relevance. And I literally see that. I literally see it. It's not just, I'm not just parroting some words I read in a book. I see it. I know it. I'm convinced of it. That's that conviction that enables you to turn it all over. What was that? Huh. So it is that conviction to just turn it all over and not feel any trepidation or like, oh, am I making a mistake? Or I didn't have second thoughts. No, I don't have any second thoughts now. Take it all. Take all the beauty. Take all the ugliness. Take every last speck of it forever. I don't want any of it. Now, I don't watch the news. I was given this grace of recognition. It's time to tune out the news. I've practiced this over the years many times. I've gone years and years without even watching the news at all. No newspaper, no news, nothing. Years and years and years. But you feel kind of isolated if you do that, actually. It's rough. But right now, I suggested to myself, and I suggested to everyone in the world here, the consciousness of the planet suggesting it, that tune out the news, stop watching it. And that's why I did that. It's been, several weeks now or so that I don't look at Yahoo, I don't watch Google, I don't look at Drudge Report, I don't look at this report or that report or any news source. I don't read the headlines in the newspaper. I don't try not to listen to the radio news, and no source of news. But of course, people mention events. They say, hey, what about that terrible thing? Or what about this terrible thing? I go, and so it kind of, I get sort of notices, and I say, I start going to say, yeah, that's awful. Wasn't that tragic or something? But of course, if there's some big news event, everyone's going to tell you about it, right? So you feel like you need to keep up on it, but really you can kind of fake it, say that you're, or you can say, yeah, I'm just kind of, what happened? There's a way to kind of ease past it. It's not easy because everybody's so tuned into the news now. But actually, really take it to heart to try and tune out the news right now, because you're not only getting news, you're getting all the reactions. It's one thing to say this is what happened or whatever, just the bare bones of it. Some tragedy, a lot of people died, a lot of deaths or whatever. And it's another to get in all the details, all the gory details, get immersed in it, get immersed in everybody's reactions, all this kind of stuff. That's a whole different thing. And I refuse to do that, even with, you know, major catastrophes. I haven't done that. You say, okay, there was a huge, event, and all right, now let's get back to surrendering all of existence, letting go of all of it, turning it all over. That's what has to be done. Now, here is something that can be said, which is a very profound response to whatever happens in the world at any time. whatever happens, and that this is going to stretch the boundaries of your acceptance, for sure, for sure. But it is true. So let us try some of the stretching. The spiritual path is like flexibility exercise, like stretching. Because you have to go, let's stretch a little further. It's like that. Let's be very flexible in acceptance. The truth is that nothing has ever happened here. There's nothing in existence. In fact, existence has never even happened. It's all a hypothetical. So all those deaths are a hypothetical. In other words, it's what if there were bodies? And what if these bodies were killed? And what if this happened? And what if? It's all what if. No one's ever died. Death has never taken place. There's never been any death whatsoever. There's never been any birth whatsoever. We also say, what if there were bodies and bodies gave birth to other bodies? And what if there was this world? And what if there was this universe? And what if these bodies went through these situations? And what if these bodies went through this and that and that? And what if these bodies died this way or these bodies died that way, etc.? None of it's ever happened. It's all a hypothetical projection into an imaginary place we call the future, where none of this has actually happened. None of it. There hasn't been a single thing ever happened. That is the truth. That is a fact. So when people say, well, what about this tragedy? It's kind of, well, what if this tragedy did happen? It is actually a what-if scenario. What if this were to happen? And then we say, well, then what would our reactions be to this? What if we were to have reactions to this? That's also what if. What if this tragedy were to happen? And then what if we had these type of reactions to it? And what if we then went on and did this? And what if we took these steps? And what if it's all, the entire scenario of existence is what if. What if this were to happen? In other words, in the future. And the past is just merely all these moments of the future being cataloged. This what if it were to happen in the future, moments strung together like on beads. So really, we're talking about a hypothetical future. That's not, forget about the past or what anyone talking about the past. It's not necessary. There isn't any such thing. Our situation is entirely in what if this were to take place in the future. Because in reality, we know reality's always been the way it is. So we can't possibly say that it wasn't something that changed before. We can only postulate a change in the future. That's the only place we can postulate it. So this whole hypothetical scenario is set in what we call the future. All of it. And all these moments we've strung together and saying, well, that there's some past. No, it's all these moments, where what if moments, just strung together. And that's all we're doing. It's all the situation is. Nobody's ever died. Nobody's ever been born. There's never been any stars. There's never been any planets. Never been any energy. Never been any universe. Never been any of it. None of it. It's never even arisen at all. Not really. Whoa, what happened right there? It's lost suddenly. Complete white screen. Interesting. None of it's ever occurred. And none of it will ever occur. None of it will ever occur. There'll never be any real bodies, never be any real death, never be any real energy, never be any real arising of any of this stuff, never be any real reactions, never be any real concepts, never be any real words, never any of this that's arising in existence. None of it will ever be real. None of it will ever really arise. None of it. Zero. Reality doesn't need any of it to arise. None of it. That is the truth. That is literally a fact. Now, what we do with that fact, well, we can simply accept it. We don't need to do anything with it. Because all we could do with it is say, well, what if this weren't a fact? And it is a fact. So what's the point of saying, well, what if this weren't a fact? What if all this really was true? That's still a what if. It's still all a what if. We're saying, what if all this were true, were actually happening? But none of it is. None of it is. So this is a very different way to look at the world, but it's actually a factual way that leads to your freedom from this scenario. Because as long as you're willing to entertain the premise that we need this contingency plan, then we will act as if all this what ifs are actual. And then, of course, we're going to be just brutalized by it, and we're going to feel it's so real. Almost. It's so imaginary. Imagination will seem very real. Almost. Not quite. There'll be some part of us that doesn't buy it, and we'll try to get rid of that part. Do everything we can to get rid of that part. We'll try to collectively vote it out of us. We'll take a vote. The planet will say, 80% of the planet has decided that that part of us that knows that all none of this is real is no longer functional. So that's it. It's gone. No more. No mas. And we'll try to vote it away completely. And if the vote doesn't work, we'll try to re-educate it away. And if the re-education doesn't work, we'll try to exterminate it in some way. Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But for those who are able to accept, acceptance is the key, really. No one has to do anything except just accept facts. That's all. How difficult can that be for anybody, just simply to accept facts? We don't have to sustain facts. Facts are self-sustaining. There's nothing we need to do to sustain it. All we have to do is accept it. How difficult can that possibly be? Not difficult at all. So I'm doing that right now. I accept that this is all a what-if scenario. It's no trouble. No trouble doing that whatsoever. No effort. I don't have to be holding my breath. I don't have to be chanting. I don't have to be doing anything. It's just a simple acceptance. That's all. You just say, feel I'm okay with that. That's not causing any trouble in my mind. It's not causing any fear, any regret, any difficulty. It's just a fact. It's all what if scenario projected into this hypothetical imaginary space called the future. Really, the whole universe is just an imaginary space called the future. And that's all. Then we project this whole what if scenario into that imaginary space. Some people, I'm not going to get into terminology right now. It gets a little sticky, really. But there are various terms that are used for that. But let's just stick with what we're doing because it's working. This imaginary place that we've imagined is called the future. It's space. And then we project all this what ifs into this imaginary place, and that's called time. We're just all these moments of what if this could take place, what if this took place, what if this. And we just all those moments strung together, as it were, arising. We just say, oh, that arose previously. This is arising now, but it's all arising in the same place, this imaginary place called the future, and it's all a hypothetical what if scenario. And if you can just say, hear this and feel like, okay, I'd accept that, then you're very close to exchanging time for eternity, from stepping out of time to eternity. You're very close, actually. If you can just simply hear this and say, yeah, that seems right to me. It seems like a fact. It seems like I'm listening to a fact, and I accept it. It's not a trouble to accept that. Guaranteed that you're very close to stepping out of time into eternity. And a big boost would be all you need. That's all you would need, really. Once you're close, a big boost can make the difference. Where you just say, sure, you see that it's not frightening, it's acceptable, it's wonderful, it's blissful, there's no problem whatsoever. You get reassured. That's all it is a little reassurance goes a long way. When you're prepared, a little reassurance is all that it takes. It gives a big boost. And so again, we are looking for that little bit of reassurance. Meanwhile, doing everything we can to prepare even further for that. And maybe in our preparation, maybe we'll decide, what the heck, let's not even wait for the big boost. Let's do it right now. Of course, it has to be done right now, always now. I do it right now. Because you're surrendering all time, so you have to surrender time right now, right? There's no, if you're surrendering time, exchanging time for eternity, that exchange takes place right now. It doesn't take place in time at all. Let go of time within time. You can't exchange time within time. You can only exchange it from now, because again, all time is a hypothetical place called the future. And what you're doing is you're saying, I don't need this hypothetical place called the future. And what is saying I don't need it? Right now, The eternal now is saying that. The eternal now says, the eternal now doesn't need a hypothetical place called the future. It doesn't need time. It doesn't need time. What is time except the arising of all these hypothetical what-if moments? That's all that it is. It's hypothetical. Time is hypothetical. No such reality as time. None whatsoever. Totally imaginary. So is space. Time and space are both totally imaginary. Simply hypothetical. A hypothetical, like, what if, and where does this hypothetical come from? That's what my specialty of looking at this, and it's very important, is because spirit chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. That's why. And from that choice, obviously, reality would have to be changed. Obviously, because spirit is not prime creator. So if spirit wanted to be prime creator, obviously, reality would have to be changed. And also, just as obviously, since reality is one seamless whole, any change in reality would change all of it completely, entirely, and it would be annihilated. So this desire to be prime creator automatically gives rise to this hypothetical scenario. And since it's not happening now, this change, this annihilation, we have to imagine it's happening at some point we call the future. At some point, it's not now, so we make up this hypothetical called the future, our time, and we then symbolize this annihilation in this hypothetical time and space with all these events, etc., what if events, and then try to find a way to survive the annihilation, which is specialness, that we try to focus that there's something special that is going to be able to survive it, which is again totally imaginary. And we seek for special people who feel that we're special too. And when they look at us, we think, oh, they think I'm special. That means I'm going to survive annihilation. And I think they're special. So they're going to survive annihilation. So together, we will survive annihilation. We'll have this perfect dyad that will survive. We'll have soulmates, and that will survive the annihilation because we're both special. You can see that, right? Obviously, all that is just nonsense. It's all hypothetical still. It is not what frees you from. What frees you is to see it all very clearly, simply and clearly, and say, hey, I don't need any of this. This is not necessary. Reality can never be changed, can never be annihilated. There'll never be any need for to use continuous land at all. Never any need to use it at whatsoever. So I can just turn it all over to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit, simply for the purposes of my functioning here and helping others, will return it in a beautiful, purified way. But still, that still doesn't belong to me. It's still not mine. I've given it up forever. It's still completely unnecessary, but it's pragmatic. All that it is pragmatic to help others who need some reassurance. That's all it is for. That's all it is for. See, Ananda Maima had this incredible bliss, but even that she wasn't identified with. She always said, beyond that is what's called the great bliss. And she said, I'm not even identified with all the names and spirits that she shared. In the slightest bit, even identified with those. And she said that. She said, no, this is all for you. It's all play for you. It's all a play for you. For me, I'm not even identified with any of this whatsoever, which is fact. That's a factual statement. Factual statement. She had it all. The entire package was right on the money. Even this samadhi, this bliss, this vision of Christ, etc., even that, we're not identified with that. But we don't reject it. We say, okay, Holy Spirit, you want to wrap me in this garment? Go ahead, that's fine. I'm not objecting to it. But I'm not identified with it. I don't need it. It's not necessary for what I am. It's not necessary for reality. Not necessary whatsoever. And it's still yours. It's still your garment. I don't own it. It's yours. See, the Holy Spirit was specifically a creation by the Prime Creator to deal with the situation that we're in. And so that we're able to give it everything, and it is able to play this play perfectly, and in the end, translate it all into a simple blessing of reality. So it's not going to get caught up in it. It doesn't get caught up in it. So it's safe to turn everything over to the Holy Spirit. Completely safe. It's not going to cause the Holy Spirit any problems. So don't own anything that the Holy Spirit gives you. Whatever garments it gives you, the vision of Christ. Don't own it. You don't own it. Say, I don't own this. It's the Holy Spirit. It belongs to the Holy Spirit. It belongs to the grace of God. It doesn't belong to me whatsoever. but I'll wear the garment because the Holy Spirit tells me that'll be useful for others to see me wearing this garment, as it were. So fine, no problem with that, no problem. That's the attitude. This is the attitude that A Course in Miracles was helping us gravitate towards. Just that, nothing more than that. Nothing fancy. Nothing fancy. Nothing romantic. Nothing. Very simple. Just the facts. That's all. Just the bare bones dynamic of what needs to be done. Very simple. Give it everything. Give all existence to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will return it in a beautiful, purified format, and He'll say, "Wear this garment," and you'll say, "Okay, not a problem." But it's not mine. It's still yours. I'm not owning it at all. Whatever happens is not because of me. It's all happenings are because of you. I'm not causing anything to happen. I'm not taking any credit for anything that's happening. It's all yours. And that's what Ananda Mahima did. She said, "I'm not taking any credit for anything that's happening. It's completely the play of God's grace with you, what you want. Me, I'm not doing anything. I'm not taking any credit for anything." Fact, very factual, very true. Great example. For me, it was like the perfect example of what A Course in Miracles is pointing towards. Perfect example. It's exactly what it's pointing towards. And we can see us, and we can do it. It's simple. It's basic. Totally simple and basic. And it's not anything more than that. It's just, the whole thing is not to make any exceptions to it. That is the entirety of the situation. And so this long spiritual path I've been on is just merely seeing if I want to make any exceptions and examining any exceptions that I was making, and then to the point where I'd say, forget it. I don't need that to be an exception. That's it. It's called examining your valuing of the world. That's what it is. That's what Jesus said to do. Once I'd taken the course for like 15 years of intense conceptual study, then Jesus said, okay, Holy Spirit said, okay, now you need to set it down. And I was happy to, because I said, too many words now. I don't need all those words. And then started examining my value of the world. And it's been pretty much split down the middle, is like time-wise, like about 16 years each, bull, something like that. Very, very equivalent. Very equivalent in time that I've taken as far as studying the curriculum and conceptually. And then actually examining my valuing of the world, focusing on that. It's been about 16 years, along those lines, 15 and a half, 16 years, 16 years. And now I'm the point where I don't feel I have any exceptions. Nothing arises to me like to say, no, I want to hold on to that. I want to take credit for that. I don't want to give that to the Holy Spirit. I want to get credit for that success or that failure or whatever. No, nothing seems to arise at all or stand out. I'm waiting for it, because if it does, I'll have to look at that. So it's been a lot of work. It's been 16 years of intense study and then 16 years of intense examining my value of the world. But the result of that is now feeling very much at ease with the bare bones basic situation. No objections. I don't feel any objections arising. Now, if I start getting into all sorts of details, I object to that, because I don't need details. You can get to this point. I don't feel a need for any details, because the bare bones is all we need, which is to say this is all completely unnecessary. We can simply choose a new idea. We have to ultimately, that's the ultimate solution, is we drop this idea of trying to be prime creator. Of course, we have to do that. But that's a given that we're willing to do that. But pragmatically, then how does it work out? We have to deal with that. And pragmatically, we turn over existence to the grace of God, the Holy Spirit. Turn all of it over, all of it, this hypothetical. And then we get back this immaculately purified, beautiful, beautiful interpretation, Holy Spirit's interpretation of it. And then we wear that garment. So then we seem like we're some radiant, blissful, incredible spiritual master. But we don't own that at all. We say, no, that's just the play of the Holy Spirit that we're wearing for pragmatic purposes to help this whole situation, help us all drop this idea of wanting to be prime creator. So in other words, it's in the right context. people would say that Jesus is great. So don't call me great. Why are you calling me great? Because he understood perfectly what was going on. This is God's play, the grace of God's play. I'm not doing anything. It's not me at all. That's what those who understand the situation clearly, that's how they see it. They know this is a fact, that they're not owning anything. Success, failure, it's all the same. And on my mom would say, let anything come, it's all the same to me. Everything is all the same to me. She said she had no special relationship with anything, nothing. She said, I see everything equally, is equal to me. No difference whatsoever. Speck of dust and my husband, all the same. I have the same relationship. No special relationship whatsoever. Taking credit for absolutely nothing. So someone said, you're a great guru, you're wonderful. And she said, I'm nothing. I'm not taking credit. Meaning, I'm not taking credit for anything that's going on. No credit, no blame, no praise, no scorn. None of that belongs to me whatsoever. I see it all as equal. She said, all praise I receive and all scorn I receive, I see it all as equal because it's has nothing to do with what I am whatsoever. Nothing to do with reality. Existence has nothing to do with reality. Zero. And never will have the slightest relevance to reality. Not at all. Yet, we need to take pragmatic steps, and that is what I absolutely accept and recognize. And what I'm all about is those pragmatic steps. Conceptually, you can clarify it all, and you'll see, oh, it was just a stupid, whimsical idea of wanting to be prime creator. We could never do that, so let's just drop that idea, and that's it. But pragmatically, we want a sense of continuity. Even though we don't really need it, we think we need it. And because of that familiarity we have, and the sense of wanting, desiring continuity, et cetera, there is this pragmatic plan. God put a pragmatic plan in place. God does have a plan for salvation. It's totally pragmatic. And the teachers pointed out what it is. And it's very simple. Turn to give it all over the Holy Spirit, everything. The entire hypothetical scenario, time, space, and all situations that arise in time and space, and all perceptions. Give it all over to the Holy Spirit, and then the Holy Spirit will return that to us in a blessed way, and then we'll wear that garment of blessing, that blessed garment, and others will see that and say, what is this? What is this? And then the Holy Spirit will say, well, you too can have that blessed garment, but you need to do the work. You need to do the study. You need to examine your valuing of the world, and then you can turn it all over. You won't feel any fear in turning all over. And again, I mentioned that when I was young, I tried to turn it all over to the grace of God when I was about, I don't know, 20 or so. I lay down on the ground like Ramana Maharshi did, and I said, okay, I give it all up. And instead of giving all up, I felt this tremendous fear, this extreme terror arise. I said, where did that come from? It's like, that shouldn't have arisen. Where did that arise from? And then from that point, I said, uh-oh, got a problem here. So then I've been trying to do it ever since, and experienced, you know, tremendous dread and fear in doing it. But at right now, I don't experience any fear. Like 99.99% gone. I don't feel, you know, maybe at some deep level, there's still some fear. But it's doesn't seem anything, doesn't seem troublesome at all. So that shows you how the steady, safe path works, which is what I always advocate, was what I really advocated. I know right now we're running out of time with this cycle, and you don't want to invest in our cycle because we're trying to get the harvest here. I mean, trying to give the big boost to those who have put in the work, either this lifetime or in a previous lifetime. See, there are some in the world here now that have done a lot of work in a previous lifetime, so they don't have to do so much work right now, and they can turn it all over and receive the blessed garment in return, and be a blessing to everybody. They may be young, might be very young, and they can do it right this moment. There's no fear for them to do it. Because like Ramana, he, previous lifetimes, or he never ever took up the whimsical idea of wanting to be prime creator in the first place. That was not in my mind, never did it. So she never entertained the hypothetical scenario at all, never had done it. And Ramana could have been the same situation, I don't know. I don't know if he ever commented on that or not. But for us, there may be some in the world, there may be avatars who've never entertained the hypothetical scenario, or there may be those who have done a lot of work in previous lifetimes, and so they're ready to drop it. They're ready right now, this moment, they're ready. And so the big boost, boom, that's all it takes for them. Just a little reassurance and they'll do it. And it could be at any age. Or it could be those like myself who is older. I'm 56 right now, who has spent a lifetime working at it, who is now ready for it because I put in the extreme amount of work. What else is a lifetime for except to put in this work? That's what it's for. And those who don't put in this work, wasting their time. Just wasting their time is all. That's the best that can be said. That's all that needs to be said. Simply wasting their time. No, nothing else needs to be said. And putting in the work is necessary. At some point, you have to put in the work simply to clarify it and reduce the fear. Reduce the fear. That's all I did was reduce the fear. Through clarification, there are ways to reduce the fear, but there's no magical ways, really. Because there's pragmatic problems of a dread of lack of continuity and all the threats that belief makes, and it all adds up to a tremendous amount of fear. And because this fear is there, we won't turn it all over. We'll make exceptions. We'll still seek for specialness. And so we cannot, God's plan cannot be implemented the way it needs to without vetting the situation. The situation has to be vetted. Sooner or later, it has to be vetted. Now we're coming up upon a crisis in cycles of existence, where a new cycle will be beginning, and because of that, belief is trying to generate a massive amount of confusion and turmoil and crises, etc., to generate a maximum amount of feel the need for judgment, okay, the feel of, and a need for specialness and all this, which will then overwhelm people, and their minds will feel, oh my gosh, it's going to take a long time to sort this all out, and so they will sign up for another cycle of existence. That's exactly what's happening. Not that that contract is enforceable, not at all. Even if you sign up for it, you can void at any time, because there are no such thing as it's simply a hypothetical contract. It's not a real contract. There's no such thing as a real contract within a hypothetical. No such thing. So you can sign up for another cycle and then change your mind and say, no, I don't really need this. Any point in time, you can. Nothing the belief can do about it. Totally acceptable by grace of God. Anytime you can turn over all existence to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit will accept it from anyone at any time. Doesn't matter what agreements you've made, what contracts you think you've made. That makes no difference whatsoever. None of it makes any difference. So, but belief, the guidance of existence, the guidance of this hypothetical, guidance of how to survive annihilation, is trying to get everybody up. It's doing a recruiting drive. It really is doing a recruiting drive. Let's just make it bare bones, straight talk. That's exactly what it's doing. It's doing a massive recruiting drive to recruit you for another cycle of existence. And it's using every trick in the book. Every trick in the book right now. Really. It is nasty out there. It really is. If you're struggling, of course, I'm completely sympathetic to those struggles, and that's why I'm making these videos, because this recruiting drive is simply very, very bad, hardball, really hardball. Good grief. It's from one standpoint, it's humorous because belief is so desperate. It's pulling out all the tricks. But from another standpoint, it's tragic because these tricks are ensnaring so many. But we don't want to enumerate all these tricks. I've gone over them in previous videos. Or at this point, we're at the point right now where the crises are about, or the dominoes are falling, and we need the big boost. So I'm really focused on that. And we need to really be focused on that, our intent. Don't worry about cataloging all the tricks that belief uses. You can notice them. You say, okay. But at some point, recognize there is a way to get free of all this, and then say, it's not necessary to catalog anything, really. I'm even give your catalog up to the Holy Spirit. Say, take my catalog too. Don't need that either. Maybe that's the hardest one. That's probably the hardest one, is give your catalog of all the tricks that you've noticed, the belief. But at some point, that you don't even value that, because it's not necessary. It's not necessary to remedy the situation. It's not necessary. And you don't. All you need is a remedy. You don't need a catalog. The remedy is just give it all over to the Holy Spirit. Give all of it. The whole entire hypothetical. Give it all over, and it will be returned to you. The Holy Spirit won't hoard it. Say, no, it'll purify it, bless it. It will bless it and then return it in a completely blessed form to you. So your perception will be completely blessed. That's the promise that Jesus gave out, and I'm trusting in that promise. I'm going on that trust and faith. I have not yet received that blessing, and I don't know anyone that has. Well, not in my ma, certainly, but she never entertained the hypothetical scenario in the first place. But she did have the blessed vision just as a pragmatic garment to wear. But as far as someone taking a Course in Miracles and actually turning it all over and receiving the blessed vision in return, I'm not aware of anyone that has actually done that. There's some who say they have, but from my standpoint, I'm not aware that they have. But I'm going on the faith. I'm going on faith because I trust in what Jesus gave out in A Course in Miracles. I trust that this came from a place of certitude, and there's no tricks involved. There's no tricks involved. It's not a trick. So I continue to have faith and patience and trust in this, even though I have not received the results yet after almost 34 years of all-out effort. But I have reasonable anticipation that I will get it. There's no reason why I can't see any reason why I will not. Unless the whole thing was a complete scam, and I don't see that. I don't see it. Because I have an example in Anandamayi Ma where it proves it. It's not a scam. It proves there is this vision. Absolutely proves it. So. I put the two together. The two together for me was what did it for me, enabled me to maintain my efforts. I think if I hadn't come across Anandamayi Ma, I don't think I could have stayed with it like I have, really. Because when I came across her, I said, wow, this is the proof that the Course in Miracles is coming, is true. It's true. It's not a scam. It is not just some pie in the sky thing. It is literally, it means what it says literally, absolutely. It's stating just stark, bare bones facts. Totally factual. And why it's so difficult, it says because we're trying to make hold out one exception, some hidden exception. You have to ferret that out. And Jesus says you can't even make a single hidden exception or it won't work. So that's the difficulty of it. That's why it hasn't worked for me or for anyone that I know of or aware of. if it really works, the blessing is going to be quite significant. If you really turn it all over without any exception, the blessing will be quite, quite significant. You won't be able to hide it. I mean, people will notice. People will notice. There's no way you can hide it. You know, no way you can seem like, well, it's just kind of a so-so thing. No way. That's not possible. The blessing will be, the immaculate blessing of your perception will be noticeable by the world. It will radiate, it will resonate, there's no doubt about it. Can't be otherwise. So, yeah. That's what I have to look forward to. That's what the world has to look forward to. Because I've done the work. There's no way I can say I haven't done the work. It's impossible to say that. Just because the results haven't come, it means I'm still holding out some exception somewhere. I need to know what it is. I keep looking and finding stuff, but this point, I don't think it's significant. It's not like I feel like I'm going to have some severe regret, but I need to keep working at it. What else can I do? And we need to get it quick. It probably has something to do with I haven't seen all of the world. I want to see all facets of the world, so I'm watching these videos by the that take someone's journeying through all the various places of the world, and I'm looking at that. Like, I wanted to see Mongolia, the Gobi Desert, Siberia, Antarctica. I wanted to see these places, so I use YouTube to look at these places. So I'll probably just keep doing that today and in the next couple of days, and just check out Indonesia, Papua New Guinea, Australia. I want to see Queensland. Just kind of seeing these places, see the world in a non-blessed way before I accept it in a blessed way, is probably, I feel that probably is what's holding me back. Just kind of wanting just to see it all. Yeah. But how do you see it all at all? There's always another place, isn't there? See the Antarctica, see the Arctic, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe I can see it all in a vision or something. Maybe there's some kind of inner YouTube that the Holy Spirit can use and just show us the whole world everywhere. Wherever we want to see, we can see it. So we can say, kind of like Mahavatar Babaji manifesting the palace to, was it Lahiri Mahasaya or something like that? And saying, here's a totally bejeweled palace. And just manifesting and seeing it. And then he said, okay. Because that was for him, that was the last exception he was making. He was holding that out as an exception. He said, I can give it all up, but if I had this bejeweled palace, I don't know if I could give that all up. And then when he had that bejeweled palace, he said, oh, I can give this up too. Yeah, that's not a problem. So maybe for me, it's like playing on some totally beautifully private, a private, beautifully maintained golf course on the Kona coast of Hawaii or Maui or Kauai or someplace like that, some totally like super top-notch, gorgeous golf course out there with just myself, nobody, I'm just on an incredible, beautiful day, etc. Maybe that's something like I would say, I don't want to turn that over something, but so. I don't know how that could be manifested, but whatever needs to manifest for me needs to manifest really quickly, really quickly. Or otherwise, maybe I don't even need to manifest. Maybe I've been able to do it online. Do your examining of valuing of the world online, which I have done. Most of it I've done online, a lot of it. It's the right use of the internet, actually. It's the right use. So those of you who are using YouTube in that way, you're doing a really great job. It's the right use. Use it really wisely. Find out what you're still valuing, what you're holding back. Say, I'm willing to give up everything except this. And then find out what that is. My wife and I used to go into like the highest boutiques and shopping areas, etc., and examine all the stuff in there. You know, Tiffany's. What are those other things? Gucci, you name it, you know, all the very best stores. We go in there and check out everything, maybe even buy a little something or whatever, and just and do that. That was examining the value of the world. Go into like the highest hoity-toity places and Ralph Lauren, Purple Label, all this kind of stuff. And or you can get some of that stuff online, like just get one item and say, okay, now I own this. What are those handbags? A Louis Vuitton. I own this genuine high Louis Vuitton or something, used, or just a little something. I get little something, and then say, okay, is it really worth it? And I say, it's not worth it. I don't need any Louis Vuitton. I don't need any Gucci. I don't need any Tiffany. I don't need any, I don't need that stuff. And so we did that together. You can do that, you know, with your husband or wife or something, and go to some place, go to these places, do whatever you need to do, and examine your value of it. Go to like Pebble Beach. We went to the lodge at Pebble Beach, or you go to somewhere, just hang out where like it's supposed to be really ultra special. I mean, I was hanging out, get this, I was hanging out, what was all of it? I was hanging out with Tiger Woods and Michael Jordan out at Harding Park at the President's Club, and President Bush was there, the senior. I was hanging out with, just hanging out there. I was like just 10 feet. They were just chatting and talking, laughing. And I was just right there and just hanging out with them. I was also at Pebble Beach with Donald Trump, Johnny Miller, Tiger Woods, all these, you know, just, I don't know if Tiger Woods was there at that time. Phil Mickelson was there, I think. But anyway, just hanging out on this, like, supposedly the most beautiful place in the world with these, like, ultra, at that time, Tiger Woods was, like, the number one best-known person in the world, almost highly thought of, regarded person in the world. Michael Jordan was probably number two, or one and two, whatever, A and B, 1A, 1B. And I was right there just hanging out with him. I wasn't talking with him, but you know, if they wanted to notice me, they could. And actually, Tiger Woods signed my scorecard from my home golf course. He signed that, which I threw in the trash after he fell from grace, just because there's a lot of, my wife was upset with him. I wasn't too happy with him either, but I just saying, hey, he made some mistakes. You know, he had some issues. I don't hate the guy at all. I don't hate him now. He's actually a pretty good guy. That was my vibe from meeting him, that he's not a bad guy at all. He's just, you know, these things happen in this hypothetical scenario. Anyway, was hanging out there. So then I said, I don't value this. I can give this up. I don't need to do this. I don't need to hang out with these big, I can either take it or leave it. It doesn't matter either way. I can hang out with them or not. It doesn't make any difference to me. If the Holy Spirit wants me to hang out with uber celebrities, I will. If Holy Spirit wants me to golf with the president, I would. But I don't hate the president at all. You know, he has his issues that are arising, hypothetical issues that are arising too. Everyone does. Everybody does. I don't hate anybody. So if I want, the Holy Spirit says, play golf with so-and-so, I say, okay, whatever, or not. Okay, it's all the same to me. It's all the same. So basically, I mean, of course, it might have some hovering, like, well, this might be more enjoyable than this, or who do I want to really want to play golf with? Nah, it's pretty much flattened. So that's an example. That was work for me. For me, I looked at it as work. That was my work. I wasn't play or leisure or fun. It was work. I worked at it. I was at a golf tournament, one of the most exciting golf tournaments in history, really, where John Daly and Tiger Woods were dueling it out at Harding Park. And John Daly was just, it was unbelievable. All the stars were there. It was incredible. I mean, holy smokes. That was exciting. That was exciting. Because, you know, here you have this guy, and it's just, that was Tiger Woods at his best, and John Daly was at his magical best. And they were just crushing it. They were just crushing the ball. And it was just full on. It was full on golf. It's golf as good as it gets. And the crowd was just screaming, and we were just into it. It was great. But again, after, I said, well, I can take it or leave it. I can do that or not do that. It's really no difference to me. I didn't feel any real difference at all. So somehow the Holy Spirit told me to go to these places. Actually, I was told I need to go there. I wasn't going to go, and someone literally handed me some kind of program and says, you should check this out. You should go. And I said, wow, that's a sign I should go. So there was a time when all these things I did, I was getting guidance to do them. But recently, I really haven't been getting guidance to do anything. I kind of wonder, Holy Spirit, are you still there? You know, knock, 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 knock. Are you still there? I don't know. I'm not getting any guidance to do anything. I keep saying, come on, if there's something I need to do, let's do it now. Let's not wait. I never golfed at Pebble Beach, but I don't know. I don't feel any particular need to do it. I'd do it if I had to, I guess, but it doesn't seem, I don't feel like so deprived of that. I've been there, I've walked the course a number of times during tournaments and seen everything and whatever. I can't come up with anything in particular that I feel like I really need to do in the world that feels like it's a burning desire, like I have to do it. Certainly as far as clothes go, I don't feel I need to own any clothes or whatever that way. I did all that. In other words, I don't feel I need to go shopping in some boutique land that has like the best clothes in the world. And even if it was all free, I don't feel like that would really either, as again, take it or leave it, wouldn't make any difference either way. If everything in this world was free, I don't feel like it would cause me, I would like, oh, really, jump at anything. I said, well, take it or leave it, whatever. It wouldn't change my life in any way, I don't think. Imagine that. There's a good exercise for you. Imagine if everything in the world was free. Would you feel like you're like, oh my God, I got to get in a car. I got to go. You're like, whoo. And you forget your contemplation. You forget your consideration, your inquiry, your satsang. Would you forget it? Would you say, I got to drop that? Ask yourself that question, just honestly, and find out what arises for you. If everything were free, what would you do? Would you go to Tiffany's today? Where would you go? Would you go on a cruise? Would you immediately buy a motorcycle or a car? That's another thing. We went to a car thing where all these cars were being offered to credit union members. And they had all these luxury cars, and we just looked at all of them. We just walked around, looked at all of them. It was like, wow. I mean, late models, you know, new and late models. they were like repossessions or trade-ins or whatever. A lot of them had very few miles on them. All the top luxury models were there. The BMWs, the Mercedes, the Lexus. I don't know if the Bentleys were there. But we have a luxury car dealership where all the Rolls Royces and Bentleys and Ferraris and Lotuses, Lamborghinis, Maseratis, Ferraris, you name it. All of those cars are there. And then you have the people tooling around in there. Fiskars, Karma Fiskars, or whatever, Fisker Karmas, or however it goes, Karma, I don't know, and their electric cars here and everything, and you see all that, you see all the exotic cars here. I mean, see people with garages full of them, their turbo Mercedes, so that are, you know, what is it, the AMGs, M-Series, whatever. So we looked at all of those and just saw all of them, and afterwards, you know, I said, that's all cool, but then I haven't really given a thought, like, oh, I really need that car. If everything was free, I have to get that car. I don't really feel that way. I take it, you know, it's fine, whatever. Take it or leave it. A Bentley, sure, I'd take a Bentley or not. Doesn't matter, Rolls Royce or not. Actually, I probably wouldn't want a Rolls Royce, but some of the newer ones look pretty cool. I know the older ones, I used to, one of my mechanic actually worked on Rolls Royces. Someone would bring in a Rolls Royce, and that was an older one. And in fact, it was always there. And he told me, he says, oh, God, don't get those Rolls Royces. Holy smokes. They got so many problems, you can't believe it. It's just constantly, the guy never drove it. He like would drive it for a few days, and that was it, and he'd bring it back to the shop. It's always being worked on. Wow, what a pain, what a pain. So if everything was free, what would you get? What would you feel you need to make a beeline for? Like a bee going to a flower. What would you go to? For me right now, I can't think of anything that I'd make a beeline for. I really cannot. I need to, but you know, don't give up on this. If you just think, well, I don't think there's anything, don't give up. Say, wait, let me see if I can find anything. Let me see if I can find anything. Is there any golf course I want to play? Like Augusta National. Take it or leave it, as far as golf courses go. As far as places to go, countries, take it or leave it. Can't think of any place I feel I have to go, no way. Take it or leave it. Any house that I would want to buy, take it or leave it. I've been in so many mansions. I was just in recently, and a guy was fixing something there, and I said, hey, you know, the more money you have, the more problems you have. And he said to me, the bigger the house, the bigger the problems. Okay, I said, yeah, amen, that is true. That is really true. You see all the problems that these mansions have, the people have, tremendous maintenance and upkeep and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So, no, I wouldn't make a beeline to buy any house, to be any place in the world. Not really. It might be Hawaii, but actually, Hawaii is quite dangerous in many ways. You cannot just walk by yourself down a beach in Hawaii at nighttime, if you're a white person, a white male, especially a white person. No way. Way too dangerous in Hawaii, and all the drug problems there, methamphetamine problems, etc. Nah, it's a lot of danger there, really. And that's actually how it is. So you just cannot carefree go strolling on some walk somewhere. No way. I mean, we had someone from the Bay Area went through a horrible attack there, absolutely horrible. Just, you know, walking on a hike, just happy as can be, for no particular reason, just got completely bushwhacked. So, you know, if you were in like some Four Seasons resort on the Kona Ghost or something, hanging out at a beach there, well, you know, yeah, but you don't have the carefree. I used to live in Hawaii long ago, in 1958. Back then, it was quite carefree, actually. You could stroll anywhere without a thought. Almost without a thought. But not quite. But still, it felt like paradise back then. Now, no, it's not that way at all. Not that way at all. I wouldn't feel safe. I wouldn't feel safe at all. No way. So, why would I want that? Why would I want that? I wouldn't. So there's no place in the world, no car, no house. accessories, jewelries, gold, etc. No. Take it or leave anything. Any clothes, take it or leave it. Anything. Any people I want to hang out with? No, take it or leave it. I can't think of a single person in the world I'd want to hang out with. Not even one. I'd take it or leave it. Like, well, for instance, like someone would say, what about Muji? No, take it or leave it. Take it or leave it. What about any spiritual teacher? Take it or leave it for me. I wouldn't make a... I don't know anyone I make a beeline to in the entire world. Not one single person here. What's that? Is it raining? Yeah, it is. It's starting to rain. What about a university or a classroom? No. No university, no classroom, no schooling. What about a book? No. No book. Not a single book. What about musician? No. No musician. What about a music? No place. What about recording studio? No. No place. That's one that some people would be attracted to. You know, wow, what about a recording studio or like a session? What about a session where you could name all the session musicians you wanted and the producer and all the equipment, and then you could go in and cut a CD, cut a DVD or whatever, CD. I don't know what they do these days. cut some tracks, that MP3s, cut some MP3s or whatever. See, what about that for you? And you could have any backup singer you wanted. Any backup, any group of singers, whatever. You could have who are the singers? And Andrea Bocelli or what are some of those other ones? I don't know. Darling Love, you could have Darling Love on singing background for you. And you could have all the Nashville studio musicians, session players, whoever. Pedal Steel, someone on Pedal Steel. Who'd you have on Pedal Steel? I heard someone on Pedal Steel recently that was unbelievably good. Holy smokes. Who was that? I can't remember the name. It was ridiculous. But you could have them on Pedal Steel, whatever, anything you want. You could have Placido Domingo singing for you. Or you could be backstage. Any musical scenario. But the recording studio is one that might tempt some. You could have the Neumann tube mics, all analog boards, everything, anything you want. Old Marshall stacks, vintage 69 Marshalls. I used to have that stuff. So for me, that doesn't hold any appeal. Take it or leave it. Make no difference. I could be singing a duet with George Jones. Take it or leave it. Wouldn't make a beeline for it at all. No way. What about all the gambling establishments, all the pleasure palaces of the world? Take it or leave it. All the courtesans, all the escorts, etc. Take it or leave it now. Mostly leave that. Leave it. Leave all that. But whatever thrills, pleasures, etc. Disneyland, resorts like that. Take it or leave it. Take it or leave it. Mostly leave it. Mostly leave everything, but take it or leave it. You know, hanging out with somebody, no. Hanging out with Warren Buffett or some Bill Gates or Serge Brin or Meg Whitman or all these, you know, these high-tech gurus, etc. Nah, take it or leave it. Take it or leave it. If they want to have tea and crumpets, fine. How about the queen or the royal heir apparent, etc.? Nah, take it or leave it. Maybe some Brits that might be hard to understand. Or maybe not. Maybe not for them. Me again, it would be exactly the same as hanging out with a neighbor or someone walking down the street. It wouldn't make any difference whatsoever. Exactly the same. I don't see any significance. Same with all heads of state around the world. Take it or leave it. Wouldn't make a beeline for any of them. Let me see. Keep looking here. You can probably come up with some, maybe. Some place, some mountaintop, some sacred place in the world, Machu Picchu, and I'll take it or leave it. Stonehenge, Shambhala, under the earth. I'll take it or leave it there. Take it or leave it. Some gated, elite gated community, take it or leave it. There's some pretty nice places, some not pretty nice places, but take it or leave it for me. So what the heck? Some restaurant. Good question. Take it or leave it. Because the truth is, my wife's cooking is actually better than any five-star restaurant in the world. That's actually a fact. So I can get that anytime. And so again, take it or leave it. As far as any, what is it, the laundry, French laundry or whatever, some places. If someone treats me, I'd go. I'd order something probably, sure. But again, it'd be take it or leave it. Any occasion, how about an occasion? Any occasion. How about meeting ETs? Take that or leave it. Again, take it or leave it. How about the Zeta Reticulans, the Greys? Meeting them, take it or leave it, mostly leave it. Of course, they're different ones. Some are more malevolent than others. About the blonde Nordic types, take it or leave it. The Draconians, take it or leave it. How about Ascended Masters? Same thing, take it or leave it. Saint Germain, Mother Mary, Joaquin, all those Ascended Masters, whatever all their names are, Sanat Kumara, Master Maurya, Maitreya, all those. Take it or leave it for me. I wouldn't make a beeline to them. Would not. Even in Jesus, even Ananda Mayama, Ramana Maharshi, would I make a beeline? Probably, again, take it or leave it. If they came to me, if that's the Holy Spirit wanted that to happen, that's fine. But I don't think I would make a beeline. Don't need to. I don't feel I need to. It doesn't, even that, I don't feel like I need to. But if like Ananda Mayama was here in town, I probably would get over there. Yeah. I'd have to say that. I probably would, if Jesus was here in town, I would get over there. If Ramana Maharshi was in town, I would probably get over there. But as far as I know, they're not in town. So that may be hypothetical. But dealing with what's actually here, anything, let's see. How about a movie set? Making a movie. There you go. Movie star, meeting movie stars. Take it or leave it. Mostly leave it there. But if you could star in a movie, have the entire studio at your disposal, all the props, all the technicians, the production managers, the whole ball of wax, totally at your disposal, totally free to use, would you make a beeline to make a movie? Me? Would not. No way. Take it or leave it. I've made tons of movies in my life. Different types. I was making movies back in high school. We rented a movie camera and made a movie. Back then, it was an old Super 16 or something. 8mm, 16mm. Hanging out with any celebrity in the world. Any celebrity. Take it or leave it. No, I can't think of a single one. Not one. Hang out at any company, corporation. No, can't think of anyone. Hang out in the Pentagon. Hang out in the military. No, can't. Wouldn't make a beeline for that. Even hang out in the subtle realms. Subtle realms. No? So far I've not come up with a single thing. Have some beautiful garden somewhere. Again, you could take it or leave it. Augusta National is pretty beautiful in the spring when all the dogwoods and azalea are blooming and it's groomed like that. You know, that's a pretty nice walk in a park for sure. But still, take it or leave it. I wouldn't. I'd do it. Yeah, sure, I'd do it. But I don't feel like I have to. Like, if I could do it right now, I wouldn't feel like I have to make a beeline to it. What else? Gosh, any concert whatsoever? No. See how difficult it is for me? It's quite difficult. I can't figure out what to do. I can't figure out what to do because... Let me see. Sailing the Seven Seas? I was helped greatly by a video I watched of sailing through... was it Indonesia or Malaysia? I can't remember. Indonesia, sailing through the various... I've never seen that part of the world before, and they were sailing from island to island, looking at the place, and I said, and you come up this tropical island, kind of looks neat, and you look at all the shacks on the... You start looking around and say, oh, God, this isn't so nice after all. And Or there's some place like in Queensland, tip of Queensland, looking out on this gorgeous tropical setting, and they say, well, we can't go near the beach because it's so dangerous. The jellyfish, the manta rays, the sharks, the eels, the dangerous poisonous snakes. And it's like, you know, it's really poison in paradise. They can't even enjoy it. Wow. So you kind of see this. I'm not going to make a beeline for that. How about... a beeline, how about some cave, spelunking in some cave? No, wouldn't make a beeline there. How about up in space, up in the space station? Take a ride up in the, SpaceX or something. They got some, take a ride up into space. We've seen pictures from NASA, all the different satellites that take pictures of the planet and seeing how it perspective from up above. And again, that'd be kind of cool, take it or leave it. Any weather phenomenon, take it or leave it. So I'm having trouble here. I haven't found a single thing yet. Some perfect romance strolling along the Seine in Paris and et cetera. Some travel romance. No, take it or leave it. Take that or leave it. Take it or leave it. No. Boy. How about coming up with some brilliant composition, musical composition? Take it or leave it. How about a brilliant book? Take it or leave it. Again, no traction of that. Some creation, or somehow you come up with some cure for cancer? Take it or leave it. Some invention? Take it or leave that. Not attracted to anything that could arise as far as creativity goes, as far as my being able to come up with some elegant solution or invention or whatever. Again, take it or leave it. Some incredible speech. I've come up with many incredible speeches in my mind. So now, take it or leave it. Totally. Be some hero or superstar. No, take it or leave it again. Wow, this is not easy. See, this is not easy. This is sadhana. This is spiritual practice right here. I'm just doing it on camera. This is what I do. This is the real. This is the real deal. This is the real deal. This is how you really make progress. Is take inventory. Take inventory like this. Ask yourself. Don't just dismiss it and say, "Well, probably not." Actually, do the work. It's like I have all these plants now. I got a plant, and they're in the six packs. I say, maybe I just want to, it's good enough, just leave them in the six packs and just look at them in the six packs and don't even do the work to plant them. No, I got to plant the doggone plants so I can see the flowering of them as later, you know. So we have to do the work. Paint some great painting. No way. Take it or leave it. It's amazing how I've come across all these situations in my life that enabled me to examine my valuing of all this stuff. I actually did. The Holy Spirit arranged it all in very subtle, amazing ways. And right now, wow, it seems like I'm not coming across. Well, these videos I came across has helped me tremendously, so it's still showing me stuff. But as far as, I don't know what else could be done unless I'm... Maybe if I was like dripping in jewels or diamonds and gold and something, haven't quite. Well, I once got all the ornamentation like in India, all these stuff, and I wore all that stuff. I just like had myself actually dripping in jewelry and all this fake gold, fake jewelry, all this sort of stuff, dressed up. I dress up as a god, like some Indian god guru. I dress up some Indian goddess, like in a sari and with all this jewelry and stuff. I did all that stuff. Just say, what would it be like to be a god? What would it like be like to be a goddess? What would it be like to be that? And then I say, take it or leave it. You know, this. So I did. I went through examining the value of the world. What would it be like to be some superstar or someone people look up and say, oh, you're some incredible being, or to have all the elegance in the world, complete aristocrat, king or a queen or whatever like that, and just be, and I now can just take it or leave it. It's like, it's like nothing important. Ah, it's getting cold. I swear it's snowing. It must be snowing in the mountains right now. It's gotta be. Whew, wow. Yeah, there's no question about it. I mean, it is raining right now. It's gonna be, there's gonna be snow in the mountains. Well, there again, how about going to some alpine snow resort? Helicopter skiing. Skiing in the Himalayas. I mean, I've seen all that on YouTube. And nah, take it or leave it. Trekking through the Himalayas. Take it or leave it. Just saw a helicopter ride through the Himalayas. That was pretty awesome. Pretty nice. But again, I could take it or leave it. Flying in some plane, some super jet or whatever. Take it or leave it. Good grief, I can't come up with anything here. This is really something. Man. Of course, from the 60s, some combination of sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Now, take it or leave that. Mostly leave it. Leave it. Winning the lottery. Again, take it or leave it. Often causes severe problems for people, really. It's a nightmare. I was thinking recently, what if I won the lottery, the Powerball lottery? I say, oh man, you know what? I don't think I need those problems. Really. Seriously. I mean, if it won it, God, what a nightmare. What a nightmare. Because I asked myself, what would I do with the money? I couldn't come up with a single thing I could do with it. Take it or leave it. I really could not come up with anything. I said, wow. And of course, there'd be troubles coming out of the woodwork. You'd be assaulted. They'd be assaulted. You would be people, all the charity people who make their livelihood from charities would come after you with claws. You know, all these sleek... These sleek cougars would come after you with claws saying, give to this charity, you know, I know how to spend your money. Say, no thanks. Thanks, but no thanks. That's how a startup, venture capitalist and stuff. Now, again, take it or leave it. Take it or leave it, sure. Some people would think, oh yeah, if I had all this money, if everything was free, I'd be a venture capitalist. I'd do all these cool startups. You know, and they get hooked in that. For me, no. Even if I would like have opportunity like to start the next Google or Apple or something, no, that's completely take it or leave it. No beeline for that whatsoever. How about owning some gadgets again? Whatever you get, all gadgets for free. Take it or leave it. Any experience in the world you could have free. Take it or leave it. I can't think of a single one that I would make a beeline for. So you can see how it is easy for me to, again, just turn it all over to the Holy Spirit. I can't come up with anything that I would say, no, not yet. I need to do this first. I can't. How about running for president? Now, again, take it or leave it. Running for office of any type, take it or leave it. How about being named Pope or something? Again, take it or leave it. How about being named to any office or take it or leave it? I can't think of any position in the world that I would accept to make a beeline for. So, okay, yeah, jump at it and say, okay, I can accept that. Can't think of a single position in this world at all. It's all take it or leave it for me. Really. If you can come up with one, let me know. I can't think of one. Even like the greatest guru in the world, again, take it or leave it for me. Seriously, I'm absolutely serious about that. If someone said, okay, you're the next Ramana, I said, well, take it or leave it, whatever. Of course, I would take it, but I wouldn't own it. I wouldn't identify it. It's take it or leave it. If not, it's all the same. It's all the same, really. It's all the Holy Spirit's play. It's not my play anymore. So if the Holy Spirit wants me to play as the next Ramana, fine. If not, fine. I mean, it wouldn't be my play anyway. It's not my play at all. So I can't come up with any play in existence that I would want to play. Can't think of anything. Follow your joy. You know, I can't think of any joyful path in existence that I would want to follow at all. None. So turn over all paths in existence to the Holy Spirit. All so-called paths of joy. I can't come up with a single one. Not a single one. Meeting everyone in the world, again, take it or leave it. In fact, the hugging Saint Amma, hugging all these people, again, for me, take it or leave it. Something like that, take it or leave it. I wouldn't make a beeline for that. Whatever. It's all a play of God's grace anyway. However God wants to play is fine with me. Doesn't make any difference, really. And that's what Ananda Mahima said. She'd say, whatever comes, it's all the same to me. Meaning, whatever the play of God's grace occurs, it makes no difference to me whatsoever. However the play wants to play, let it play that way. She said, for me, I'm prior to all of that. Prior to all that, it doesn't change what I am in the slightest bit. No relevance whatsoever. And that's how I feel. I cannot come up with anything, any play that I would need to want to identify with, that I wouldn't want to hand over to the Holy Spirit and say, hey, it's your play. You play it the way you want to play. It doesn't make any difference to me. Can't come up with any path into the future that I would want to hold on to, really. How about being some martyr and being named a saint or something? No, take it or leave it. Leave that one, actually. that doesn't interest me at all. What if you would do something and you'd be named some saint and there'd be statues of you in St. Peter's Square and people would invoke you as their patron saint, etc. in the future? For me, take it or leave it for me. No, not interested. Take it or leave it situation entirely. What about being the most famous person in history? Again, take it or leave it. If I were to be offered, you can be the most famous person in all of existence. For me, that's, again, take it or leave it. That's a good one to think about right there. What if you were offered that you could be, hands down, the most relevant, most famous person, being, entity, in all of existence? When the existence comes to an end, you would be number one. And for me, I can honestly say that's a total take it or leave it thing. I could care less either way. If that's how it plays out, fine. If that's how it doesn't play out, fine. I don't see any difference. It doesn't make any difference to me whatsoever. That's how I honestly feel about it. Simply because of the fact this is all completely unnecessary and we will forget all about it as if it never happened at all. What does it matter? None of it matters in the slightest bit. So, all attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile, equally unnecessary. So nothing doesn't matter at all what takes place here. Now, as far as being completely irrelevant, I'm talking about I'd gladly give that up. I'm talking about what you don't want to give up, what you're holding on to, what you're not willing to turn over. Of course, the terrible stuff you're willing to turn over. It's the good stuff that we're not willing to turn over, the supposed good stuff. So I'm just doing an inventory of that. How about happiness? You're like the happiest person in the world. I take it or leave it. What good is happiness? Really, take it or leave it. Because, of course, happiness is subject to unhappiness. So, why would you want that at all? I want to turn it all over, all the happiness too, all the joy, everything in existence, anything that can be experienced in existence, I want to turn that all over the Holy Spirit entirely, anything whatsoever. Including the bliss, including the joy, including the happiness, including all of that. The fame, the fortune, the glory, you name it. All of it. All of it. Because all of it has absolutely zero necessity. As Ananda Mahima said, behind all of this is the great bliss of reality. The great bliss, which is beyond anything we can imagine or conceptualize, and don't even bother about worrying about that at all. But beyond it all is the great bliss. So turn everything else over to the Holy Spirit. There's no necessity to it whatsoever. Never will be. Completely useless. Completely meaningless. And then it'll give back to you whatever it sees as useful for its purposes, because it's now its game. Existence is now the Holy Spirit's game. God actually turned the prime creator turned existence over to the Holy Spirit immediately, as soon as we picked it up. Because as soon as we picked it up, we realized we didn't want it, and yet we felt like some kind of fear of giving it up. So God created the Holy Spirit and gave it existence all over to the Holy Spirit. And all we need to do is accept this fact, actually, and turn it all over. Be willing to accept it. It's already been turned over. But when we accept it, then the Holy Spirit can give it back to us in a blessed condition, because we still feel we might need it at some point, right? Contingency. But then this eases the transition to recognize, no, we don't need it whatsoever. And then finally, completely letting go of it, as far as not even recognizing it ever even took place in the first place, which is beyond the scope of what we need to deal with here, pragmatically. We don't need to deal with that final step. We don't. We're dealing with just this one step. We need to hand it all over to the Holy Spirit. And is there anything that we're unwilling to hand over? There must be something. If we haven't handed it over, there must be something. I can't locate it right now. Maybe it's getting old, aging. How about that? How about a next life? Am I willing to? Do I want a next life? I want to be young again. Now hand that over. Now take it or leave it. Being young again, being born again. Take it or leave it for me. Definitely leave it, but take it or leave it. I don't care who. What body I'm born into or identifying with, in what world or whatever. Nah, forget it. Take it or leave it. Even on in utopia, being born in some perfect body in a perfect utopia, etc. Take it or leave it. I'll hand that over to. Good Lord, it's cold. Gosh, this day is. This has been a long time since we had a day like this in California. Feels like it's almost gonna snow down here. Not quite, but it's getting there. Good grief. We're not used to this. Guaranteed the mountains are gonna be, if this continues during the nighttime, the mountains are gonna be covered in snow. Gosh. How about being Lord of the world? Again, take it or leave it for me. Entirely. How about Lord of the Universe? Take it or leave it. Absolutely, take it or leave it. No interest. I had no interest in being the Lord of this world, or a Lord of any world, or the Lord of the Universe, or the Lord of any universe. No interest. How about being Ascended Master? No interest. How about being a Ascended Goddess? No interest. Ascended God? No interest. Mm-mm. Take it or leave it. A spiritual master, an adept, an avatar, or whatever. Take it or leave it. No. Again, whatever the Holy Spirit wants to give back to me, I'll give it all to the Holy Spirit. Whatever it wants to give back to me, it's fine. It's all the same. It's all the same. That's the attitude I have. It's the attitude. This is the attitude you need to cultivate. Not as an intellectual exercise, but as an actual fact. By examining your value of the world. And I know some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. I've been doing that, because you'll think, oh yeah, I was just at this some place that I thought was it. This was it for me. And then I recognize, it's not really it for me. That is called examining your value of the world. And the Holy Spirit sets that up for you, as it has for me. And that is the most valuable thing you can do in the world. Examine your value in the world. That's what Jesus told me. The most important thing you can do is examine your value of the world. Super crucial. So that you are willing to hand it all over. And then Jesus said the Holy Spirit will give it back in a blessed condition. In whatever format is helpful for the Holy Spirit to help others out pragmatically. So if it's some ascended master or some adept or some sage or some guru or some goddess or some god or some savior or some non-dual satsanga, some bodhisattva, whatever. Doesn't matter, it's all the same to me, but whatever it is, some radiant reassure, some reassurer, some ambassador of certitude. Fine. Wear the garment. You say, okay, I'll wear that garment, whatever. It doesn't matter to me. Whatever the garment is, it's kind of, well, you wear a shirt in this color or that color. You got a nice linen shirt. Whether it's going to be white or red or beige or purple or checkered or this color or that color. Well, I actually have really good linen shirts. And I wear different ones and they all feel the same. They all feel the same. So it's for me. I'll wear the finest shirt in the world. Whatever color doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. I'll wear the finest clothes in the world if necessary. It doesn't matter. And this style or that style or that style, it doesn't matter. So whatever they want, whatever anyone wants to call you, doesn't really matter to you. It won't really matter. If they want to call you, see, Ananda Mayama, wherever she went, they call her something different. Because wherever she went, everybody insisted that she was the goddess that they had been praying to their whole lives. They insisted on it. And so wherever she go, different places in India have different goddesses they worship as representing the grace of God, supposedly, hopefully. But basically, that supposedly make their life better in many cases, but hopefully to that they're willing to give their lives. It represents the principle of the Holy Spirit. Give your life, give everything over to that principle, and it'll be returned. The blessing will be returned to you. That's the principle. That is the true spiritual principle of God's plan of salvation. So I don't have anything against those practices in principle. In practice, it's often not utilized to the full extent that it's supposed to be utilized. You're supposed to ultimately give everything over to it. All of this whole hypothetical scenario, give it all over to it. Then it will be returned to you. That principle will return it to you. But so wherever she went, they would call her different names. They'd insist, oh, no, you're the Mahakali. You're Mahakali. You're the goddess Lakshma. Or you are Durga. You're definitely Durga. No question about it. Or you are... There's lots of different names. Parvati, or they'd insist. They said, "You're it. You're the one we've been praying to all this time. You're it. You've come to us. You've come to us now, and we've been waiting for you to come to us." And then they said, "You can't leave. You can't leave. How can you leave? We've been praying for centuries. Our ancestors have been praying, and you finally came, and now have visited us. We've been asking you to come to us, and now you're here. So you can't leave us now." And she said, "Well, unfortunately, this play is not my own. I'm not the one playing this play, so I have to go wherever this play takes me. So I cannot always fulfill your request that I stay." She said, "I'd be happy to, but the way this play is playing, it wants me to move on." And then she'd go to another place, and they'd insist that she was the goddess they'd been praying to for all these years in that place. So she has many, many names, actually. People call her all different kinds of names. And she'd say, actually, I'm beyond all those names. I'm beyond all those goddesses that you've been praying to. Those goddesses are all appearances within the hypothetical. But what I am is the great bliss beyond the hypothetical entirely, which is reality. She said, all of reality is all of reality. So reality presenting itself here is reality presenting itself here. It's beyond this hypothetical entirely. It's untouched by it. She said, even though the entire dance of existence dances for all eternity, in the halls of eternity, she says, what I am remains the same. Remains the same. In other words, remains completely untouched by it. That is confession of truth, confession of facts. So for her, no matter what anyone called her, it was all the same. It's all the same. She said, she didn't mind what anyone wanted to call her. It didn't make any difference to her. So, it's like that. I mean, once you receive the blessing, the blessed vision, whatever people want to call you, is it whatever. Doesn't matter. It's all the same. Guru, Master, Bodhisattva, Avatar, Buddha, Enlightened One, Ascended Master, Sage, perfect one, Savior, Christ. Guru, Satguru, Parasatguru, on and on and on and on and on, right? There are all sorts of terminologies around the world. Whatever. Maybe the Holy Spirit will say, well, why don't you accept this one for now as an expedient and go with this one? And you say, okay, whatever. Whatever you want. Doesn't make any difference to me. It's like that. That's exactly her attitude. Exactly. And someone said, well, I'm going to call you an Adimaya. She goes, okay, whatever. And that one stuck. It stuck. Because for some reason, the Holy Spirit said that one's pretty descriptive. We'll use that one. It means bliss, overflowing, ananda. Mayi, overflowing. Overflowing with perfect bliss. But again, for her, take it or leave it, and then no difference. Didn't make any difference one way or the other. And that's the attitude of reality towards this hypothetical scenario. It's willing to accept a blessed version of it simply as an expedient to help those who are not yet willing to accept a blessed version of it. And when all have accepted a blessed version of it, then the Holy Spirit will then deal with that and simply leave it as simply a blessing, but without a formless blessing. The final outcome of this hypothetical scenario will be a formless blessing. It will simply be a blessing itself. It will be the final outcome. There won't be any format or form whatsoever. That's the end of it all. That's how it ends. But for us right now, pragmatically, we take on some form, blessing that seen people will identify some format. They'll look at you and say, oh, you must be Jesus, or you must be Saint Germain, or you must be Saint Paul, or you must be Saint Peter returned, or you must be some saint, or in the Western traditions I'm talking about, you must be some spiritual master, you must be who knows, you know, what they come up with. And I don't know, those are just ways that they have of referring to existence in a blessed format. That's those the ways, traditional ways of saying that. And then, of course, people will argue about it. You can't call him Jesus, you know. Well, that's blasphemy. You can't call him Jesus. And they're getting all sorts of arguments and it's about overall all kind of stuff. And just... So the Holy Spirit will say, no, don't. That's not pragmatic to say that. Let's say this or say that. For me, it's all the same. It doesn't make any difference whatsoever what someone how they want to symbolize the blessed condition of existence in the blessed format. Doesn't make any difference to me. That's how I feel. Now we'll see how it goes going forward, but honestly, that's exactly how I feel, 100%. I don't feel any objections coming up, rising. So I'm just doing inventory here. And this is an example, a rare example of doing inventory live. I'm not recreating this, I'm doing it live. And you can see this is, you can do the same. You're seeing it right now. I'm doing it live right here, sitting outside in the Bay Area, California, and just doing it. And cars are driving past, the rain is falling. It's on a Saturday. Just doing it straight out, flat out. Take an inventory. Take inventory of where you're at. Take it. Inventory. And don't be alarmed or humiliated or shamed if their exception comes up. Of course, that's what it's for. I've been taking inventory for 34 years or more, nonstop. Always coming up with exceptions. So that's what it's for. That's what the spiritual path is for. Don't be ashamed of the spiritual path at all. Don't say, oh my gosh, I there's something that I really want to do. I better not let anyone know. No, that's not it. Say, oh, I'm so glad I found something. So now I can look at that and recognize and work on it to the point where I really can take it or leave it. You don't need to reject it. It's take it or leave it is good enough. That's all you need, take it or leave it. I'd be lying to you if I said that I wouldn't want to play Augusta National on a beautiful day. Nobody on the course. Of course I would, if the opportunity came up and everything was seemed to be right, all things considered. If it fell into my lap or something, I'd take it. Or not. Either way. But if I said, no, I hate that, that'd be a lie. And so you don't have to hate everything about existence. That's not the point. It's just simply you can get to the point where you realize none of it's necessary. So it's take it or leave it. Would I want to hang out in a satsang with Muji? Yeah, sure. But it's take it or leave it. It's not like if I didn't, I would feel all bummed out or something. But that'd be a pretty cool experience, but not that cool. You know, take it or leave it. I did an online satsang with Muji, people asking questions and stuff. It's very cool. I enjoyed the experience. I really did. But after that, I said, well, you know, it's take it or leave it. But I'd be lying if I said, I don't do that. Terrible. That's great theater. And it might even be helpful, too. Yeah, satsang can be great theater, really. The best theater, the highest theater, really. Really. So when it comes to, you know, theater, I mean, would you want to go to ballet, a dance, some circus, an opera, whatever, a Broadway play, taping of some television show. Some people want to go to some big, super popular television show. They want to go to the studio audience of that. Nah, you know, whatever. Oprah, Letterman, all those kind of things, and but a satsang like Muji holds it. That's high theater, really. It doesn't get any better than that as far as theater goes. I mean, Muji is the best at the theater, really, really. He's the best I've ever seen, for the sheer theater of satsang. He's like the ultimate ringmaster. I mean, nobody does it better. That is for sure. He's superb at that. So as far as high theater goes. Watching like Muji satsangs, for me that was like high theater, and I said, wow, that was pretty cool for a while, and then now at this point I can take it or leave it. But I did watch a lot of Muji satsangs, a lot of them, and listen to a lot of his satsangs, because nobody does it better. I've never come across a guru or a satsang facilitator that does it better, or I mean, he's really, he's got the knack. He's in that regard, he's super superstar at doing that. It's really high theater. Good grief. But I know he's been doing more live satsangs. After the one I watched, the one in Tiruvannamalai, Malai, I watched like the 5 or 6 days and really watched all the videos and stuff. And I haven't watched since, because for me, I said, wow, that's as good as it gets. And I know if I watch more, it will be that same high quality, no question. But again, for me, it's take it or leave it. I got the full feeling of it. And like watching the race to Dakar, I got the full feeling of like some incredible race. And I mean, it doesn't get any tougher than that, really. And for me, it's like, I don't really need to watch any more super races. I don't need to be part of it. I got the flavor of it. You know, that was like total endurance, totally gnarly race. Just unbelievable, really. And you see what that's like. I said, wow, okay. And thank you, Charlie Borman, for doing that, and Russ for doing those videos. All your videos are like super helpful for me, really. It was greatly helpful. You did a super job. And you and McGregor and stuff, those guys that did those videos, the long way around, the long way down, by any means, and those various videos, race to Dakar and all that stuff. Very helpful for me. To see that, really, saved me an incredible amount of time. And you know, those guys are just, you know, run-of-the-mill knucklehead types. a lot of foul language and stuff. They're just guys, you know, tough guys doing stuff. But what they did was I found fabulously helpful for me. Freed me up from a lot of stuff that I, in the back of my mind, you know, I want to be like on doing like the Dakar rally or something. I think that'd be really cool to do. But I found out it's not so cool. Which is what Charlie found out too. And then some of the guys, Matt and stuff, they said, wow, never again, my God. You see what it really is, beyond the glamour, behind the scenes, you see what journeys are, great journeys really are about. And you know, it's not so glamorous, really is not. So it is getting cold out here. Wow. Oh Lord, it's almost 2 hours out here in an immobile condition. Fortunately, I did a lot of stretching beforehand, and I'm actually still in pretty good shape. I haven't been able to work out for about the last week because I've been too wiped out. That crash diet I went on, the fruit diet, let me warn you for one thing, it works, but it's a crash diet. And I reached some point where my body suddenly was giving me signals that I was feeling very deprived. And I got some kind of vibration in my head, in my nervous system, my spine and everything was like, whoa, wait a minute. I better not push this. In the past, I would have pushed it. My wife told me, hey, don't try to do it all at once. And as usual, I listened to her. I decided, hey, you're right. I could push it, and I could keep going with it. But this time, it'd probably be 172. But I could feel like, hey, this is stupid. Don't push it. Don't push the river. And so I went back to eating regular meals, actually. But I was out of whack. I've been out of whack for a while. Feeling kind of just my whole body out of whack. And so today I did some stretching and felt okay. Everything's still okay. Plus I planted a lot of plants and that just wiped me out. Good grief, the physical postures you need to just plant a lot of plants is my body just wipes it out. I'm getting numbness in my arms and everything from doing that. In fact, my hand is numb right now. But I feel okay. I feel fine. Everything's fine. My weight is still low. My flexibility is still great. I still feel like I'm okay physically. So you hit some bumps. I mean, to tell you the truth, life is like a race to Dakar for everybody. It's like an endurance test. It is brutal. It's like a super race to Dakar. With sleep deprivation on the way for sure. How about some illness? Would I want some illness? Because illness is really weird, really strange. A lot of people actually tell you the truth. A lot of people see these severe illnesses like as the most interesting thing of all. Like, how am I being annihilated? Like that. I have had so many sicknesses and stuff, and I said, no, that doesn't really interest me. How about some gnarly cancer or some gnarly surgeries or... So, no, this is a fact. Some people value getting sick more than anything else. Really, a lot of people. Like, what about being super obese? A lot of people actually would find that extremely interesting. And come to think of it, there is some interest in it. But again, take it or leave it. Being 300 pounds, I can take it or leave it. How about being anorexic and super skinny? Again, some people find it would be very fascinating to be that. How about starving to death? Again, take it or leave it for me. A lot of people, actually, in this world, the painful, the bad, the ugly is pursued just as much as the good, actually, to a large extent. How about getting some gnarly illness or some terrible growth or some malaria or cholera or just your terrible diarrhea or throwing up all the time or smallpox or things like that? Again, take it or leave it. And here's another, this is the facts I'm telling you here. All those people get all these sicknesses and all the illness. Is it why? Because they wanted to. Because that was super interesting. They felt it was something that they really wanted to examine as is perhaps valuable in learning how to survive annihilation. And if at some point they had recognized, oh, the smallpox I have, you know what? This really, for me, it's take it or leave it. It's not that interesting. They would get well. It would drop away from them. That has to do with all the sicknesses, all the experiences in the world are because we feel that they may have some value to us, and we're not willing to turn those over to the Holy Spirit. So actually, you do need to take inventory of negative situations. Like, is there some illness that you don't want to hand over to the Holy Spirit? Like, wouldn't it be like really cool if I got, you know, people say, well, it'd be kind of cool to get bird flu. That'd be kind of cool. I wonder what that'd be like. I mean, I had that Hong Kong flu when I was young, and oh, it almost killed me. I mean, that was really bad. But the dreams that I had, the visions and the feverish visions and everything, holy cow. I mean, the experiences that I had were unbelievable. I mean, wow. I had experiences of like myself shrinking down into like nothing. And at the same time, expanding into complete heaviness, like everything. And it was like super heavy. Like I had all the weight of the universe, and then I also had none of the weight of the universe. I had these fiery visions of the whole world, the universe on fire, and all the incredible stuff. Here's another thing that people might value. How about smoking opium like the people used to do? Opium dens, like in Shanghai, etc. And just you have these incredible visions. Or many people take, what is it called? Ethnogenic substances, the psilocybin, the peyote, and then synthetic DMTs and all this kind of ecstasy and blah, 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 blah. All these ethnogens, et cetera, et cetera. They don't want to turn those over to the Holy Spirit, right? They say, no, I'll turn everything over, but not my stash. Right? Am I right or am I right? Okay? Let's get real. I mean, I guarantee you there's a ton of people in this world who are willing to give up everything in existence, but not their stash. And so for some, it's their stash of pornography. They're willing to give everything up except their stash of pornography. They won't give that up. And for some, it's their stash of jewelry or their stash of cosmetics. I mean, for some, they're willing to give everything except they've got the incredible dressing room, what do you call it, bathroom, what is it, the cosmetic room, dressing room, I guess, of cosmetics. They got all the best cosmetics and beauty secrets in the world, all of them, they got it all, and they're not willing to give up that stash, absolutely not. Or for some, the stash of all the ethnogens and drugs, whatever. Some, it's all the OxyContin, the Percodin, all their opiates and stuff. They have a stash of painkillers. They're not willing to give that stash up. For some, it's their stash of alcohol. Okay? You got those who say, I'll give up anything in the world, anything at all, but I just can't give up this incredible stash of alcohol I've got because I've got, you know, I've got brandy from that cost me a fortune, or wine. They won't give up their stash of wine. Xenophiles, or there's a term for those who love wine. There's a ton of those people in the Bay Area. A ton. I mean, wine is like so important in the Bay Area. I guarantee you, I can go anywhere in the Bay Area and find a whole handful of people who would be willing to give up everything in existence except their stash of wine. They won't give that up. They say, no, I've got this wine that is like, it's been corked and it's just aging, and in 5 years it's going to be unbelievable. I'm going to have it with truffles. Oh my God, 5 years from now it's just going to be unbelievable. I can't give that up. I can't give that up to the Holy Spirit, no way, because it might not give it back to me in the right way. I might not receive it back in the right way. So see, when you give everything up to the Holy Spirit, it means you're willing to have it, Holy Spirit, return it to you, and whatever it returns to you, it decides what to give back to you, and it decides in what format how it's going to give back to you. So you might not get back that perfect Merlot or Chardonnay in 5 years, how it's going to be in 5 years. You might not get that back. Or you might. See, that's why I mean take it or leave it. You either get it, if you get it back, fine. If you don't, fine. So it's all the same to you. But yeah, ton of people that way. So and a ton of people who have some illness heading their way, and they say, oh, I really want to go through this. This is going to be really a wild ride. Get to go in the hospital. I mean, all these modern hospitals look like the mothership. I was just in a recent one that's been rebuilt here in the Bay Area. It's brand spanking new, and I thought I was in a spaceship. I swear to God, it was like, am I in a hospital, or am I in the mothership? And the rooms and everything, holy cow. And people go in there and get pampered and everything. And they've got all these doctors and nurses fussing. Oh, you know, these machines attached up to you. And my gosh, and all the medicines in the world are there. I mean, people think, hey, I'm pretty special. This is pretty special. This is pretty special to have all this stuff. I mean, remember back in the 60s, and it's gone on and on and on. I mean, the dopers. I mean, you could mess with their woman, but don't mess with their stash, I'm telling you. Or the musophiles were... philophile, right? What is it? Book people, you can mess with anything. Don't mess with my book collection, or don't mess with my music collection. You can mess with anything else, but don't mess with that. But boy, you don't want to mess with a doper stash back then. Holy cow, they'd come out guns blazing on you if you do that. And it's still that way, probably more so than ever. So those are the things you need to take stock of, whatever it is. Some people, it's their home. You can mess with anything. Don't mess with their home. That's their baby. And for some people, it's their family. It's their children. You mess with anything, don't mess with our children. Our children they say, no, I can't give up everything because I can't give up my children or my family or my wife, whatever, because I might see it differently. I want to see them grow up. Okay, that's another huge one. Are you willing to give that up? Are you willing to give up your perception of your children, of your family, of your all of that, and then have it returned to you in the format, in a blessed format? Which the Holy Spirit, of course, will do. It's not going to take anything away from you that is an intrinsic part of your life. So, of course, you'll still be able to see your children. But you'll see it in them blessed, in a blessed format. You'll see everything is blessed. But you see, the problem is we want something special. So it's not like you'll see your children as blessed and then others is not blessed. You will see everything in existence as blessed. Everything. So then you think, well, it doesn't really feel like my child yet because it doesn't feel special to me. Well, it'll feel blessed to you. Your child will feel completely blessed to you. And what's wrong with that? Isn't that better than feeling special to you? That's something that a lot of people need to consider. Because for a lot of people, the family is the final obstacle, is the final hang-up. For me, it's not, because I chose not to have any children. Why? Because I knew it would be a hang-up. That's why. I knew coming into this life it would be my last life, and so the Holy Spirit arranged things so I would not have some, you know, severe hang-ups. And certainly, having children can be a real tough one, no question about it. And yet, it's not insurmountable, because I know those who have surmounted it. There have been those who, some modern mystics who were able, women in particular, who were able to even hand over their children to the Holy Spirit. I mean, hand it all over, and then they got it back in a blessed format. That has happened. That has happened. I've heard accounts of that. I don't remember their names. Where they, the children now were. Oh, I know one. A German lady gives that song. I don't know. I don't know if she's has turned over all of existence or not, but at first blush it seemed like she had, and then watching more, I felt there was like some little instability there, or something, or not. I'm not sure. Can't remember her name, but I can look it up somehow, because I think I may. Yeah, there's some way I can find. I forget what her name is. I don't know, it's just the way her website was being presented and everything. I just kind of felt like, I don't know. But she talked about how her children, how she was able to completely turn her children over to the Holy Spirit. And now she sees them as blessed, but she doesn't see them as special. And she explained this very clearly. And so when I heard that, I said, wow, this is someone who's talking very factual about doing this. I was very impressed by that. It's not easy for any woman to do that, for sure, but it's doable. And then she talked about how people thought she was crazy and she was an unfit mother and they want to take her children away from her, which is another issue, right? For women, women who have children don't have it easy at all. Which is why I always say to women, don't have children. If you want this to be your last life, don't have children. Don't have children. Really. You're super blessed if you don't have children. I knew a woman that didn't have any children, and she had quite a spiritual success. Didn't reach the goal completely, but had used her life very, very wisely in examining her value of the world. But having children is, for women, can be a real stumbling block. Men, it's not as difficult. We're not as attached in that way to children. Most men are not. But the maternal attachment to children can be a very, maybe the most difficult stumbling block in the whole world, really. So my advice to all women who don't have children, especially during these times, I can't understand why during these times any woman would want to have children right now. I cannot accept that they are going to invest in another cycle, because like Jesus said, woe to the women in those times who are with child. It's going to be very, very tough for them. Certainly it is a fact that can be quite difficult. Why? Because the way the world is right now, it is so easy for a woman to be judged an unfit mother. I mean, the laws are just insane, totally insane right now. And I have utmost sympathy for women in the world. It is so difficult. Because if you want to follow a spiritual path, it's easy for someone to tag you as being an unfit mother. And then it's very easy for social services to take your child away. And you haven't done anything wrong at all. In fact, you've been a great mother. And in fact, accepting the vision of Christ for yourself is the greatest thing a mother can possibly do, because her children will actually grow up in the best situation possible. Having a mother who's enlightened, who's seen the vision of Christ, is the best situation for a child to grow up in, bar none. And yet the world sees it completely opposite and would deem them as being completely crazy and unstable and incapable of raising a child that can adapt to society in the right way. They'll think, well, this child can't fit into society. Well, guess what? A child can also accept the vision of Christ at any point and also be a great resonator of reassurance to the world. Any child can do that. So the laws of society are extremely draconian right now and super biased against accepting reality as it is, recognizing the hypothetical is completely unnecessary, accepting the vision of Christ, totally biased against it. So of course, women are under the gun that way. It's really terrible. So if you don't have children, you're blessed, very blessed. Of course, the maternal thing is still there. So you, but the whole idea is you have to give up specialness. That's all. You have to. You can't have anything that you deem is special, because specialness is entirely your attempt to find a way to survive annihilation, which is totally unnecessary. So totally delusional, and there's nothing special in reality at all. So by having children, for most, it's a desire to experience something special. For most, not for all. No, for some women, they're advanced enough on the spiritual path where it doesn't feel that way to them at all, and they somehow are able to detach from it, which is good, which is great, and eventually even say, hey, even my children, I don't deem them special. I'm even willing to let the Holy Spirit bless them and not holding them out. I'm willing to have the entirety of existence blessed, including my children, including my husband, including all my friends, my relatives, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I'm willing to see them in a blessed condition entirely. I mean, in other words, in a non-special condition. It happens. It's been done. Women have done it. Women can do it. And they have to do it. There's no special dispensation for women. In God's plan, there's no special dispensation. No, there is not. There's no inside drag. It's not like they can say, well, God, surely you don't mean for me to not see my children as special to me. I mean, you have to make a special plan for me. And of course, there's a lot of female teachers who have actually been running with this thing and trying to sell this to women. And a lot of women have bought into it. It's totally bogus, absolutely bogus. There is no special plan for women. No difference whatsoever. You have to give up all specialness. You can't have any exception whatsoever. Nobody can. And take that fact to the bank. So don't run with any of these teachings that tell you that somehow women have the inside track and they're special and there's some special plan for them because, of course, you don't expect to not see something special. Oh, come on, that's expecting too much. No such thing coming from God. No such thing as that whatsoever. But on the same hand, it can be done. Women can do it. Has been done. And will be done and must be done. But consider not having children. Really, seriously. I chose consciously no children. Forget it. I'm not going to do it. It's a choice. I knew it was a choice on my part. And it was a will. I had to stick to it. It wasn't difficult because I knew it was the right thing to do. But the ancillary stuff was difficult because you feel like an outcast. You feel like an outcast. Now, I do have stepchildren, but it's not the same as having biological children. It's not the same. Now, some people have it. Now, some women give up their children for adoption, right? So a lot of women do. So it can be done. It's not like there's some biological, genetical DNA thing where women can't do it. That is nonsense. It's not true. But that's being peddled in the world. Women are precludes them from being able to give up all specialness. Therefore, there must be some other way, for women. That is not true. That's a lie. That's a lie coming from belief. And yet that lie is being promulgated throughout the planet to an alarming extent during these times. But don't fall for that nonsense. And if you're a man, don't fall for that nonsense. Don't think you need to make special considerations for women because somehow they're different and they therefore must have some different plan of salvation for them and they don't have to give up specialness. Whoa, what's going on here? That is not true at all. Don't fall for that. If you're a woman, if you're a man, don't fall for that. That's a very deceptive path, very deceptive lie of belief. Realize that everyone has to get to the point where they are willing to hand it all over to the Holy Spirit. All of it, without any exception, without anything being held out to be special whatsoever. And again, specialness is what? It's the attempt, the belief that there must be some way to survive the annihilation of reality. That's all that it is. That's its origin. That's all that it is. And there isn't any such way. And we don't need any such way because reality can't be annihilated. It's a moot point. It's all a moot point. It's a moot contingency. We don't need that contingency. Holy cow, this day is just now getting... Maybe we should end it at this point. Because it's been one heck of a session here. One heck of a session. Oh, gosh, here comes the mail person. Just delivered a package. And if you find yourself stuck, listen to the Holy Spirit, listen to the inner grace, the inner guidance, intuition of maybe there's a way to get over that valuing of something. Whatever it is. For me, it was like I wanted the best linen shirt in the world. Because I like a really nice linen shirt. What would it be like to have a great linen shirt? And so I found it on eBay for really cheap. I found some actually. I got a number of them. So what would it be like if I really had a wardrobe of really nice linen shirts? I found them on eBay for really cheap, and I got them and I have them now. I like them. It's good. That's what I wear. Linen shirts, really good linen shirts, are cool. Seems like you never have to wash them. We can't wash them, have to dry clean them, but it seems like they last forever, and they just don't take on the dirt and the smell and all the stuff. It's just amazing. You can spot wash them and everything. It's just, they're good shirts, actually. But if there's something that you, whatever it is, check it out and say, maybe there's something I can do, it's possible to deal with that craving or thrill or whatever it is and say, you know what? Nah, take it or leave it, man. This isn't worth dying for. This isn't worth signing up for another cycles of existence for, going through other lives for. It's not worth it. It's ridiculous. I can hand this over to the Holy Spirit. And again, whatever it is that is pragmatic to help the Holy Spirit will be returned to you in a blessed condition. And you will see that all of existence is blessed. But from a practical standpoint, like if you need a car, whatever it is, you'll have it somehow. You will have it. But for you, it won't make any difference. whether you're driving a Bentley or a Volkswagen, it won't make any difference to you. Not really. Take it or leave it. You just say, it'll be all the same to you, really. Whether you live in a mansion or a shack, it'll be all the same. Whether you're rich or poor, all the same, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And whatever it is helpful will be your garment. But what you'll experience is all of existence is equally blessed. You'll experience the overlay, as I call it. You'll experience the overlay. That's what you'll be experiencing. And so your life will be completely blessed without exception. And then pragmatically, others will see you in a certain format, in a certain way, whatever is most effective. But they will certainly experience, you're radiating the certitude and blessedness will certainly be radiating from you. There's no question about that. That will always be the case, whether you're driving a Volkswagen or a Bentley, it doesn't matter. That will be radiating from you. Okay, wow. It is just really, really chilly out here. Good Lord. I bet you if we went up in the mountains right now, the snow would be falling, which I'm not going to do, which I've done before. I almost froze to death, and that was quite an experience. I don't want to do that one again. I'll give that one up. Again, give all your sicknesses, give all your illnesses, give all your, what is it that you think would be cool, like bungee jumping, having the bungee snap and plunging into the river. Give that, check that out and say, do I really want to do that? And some people do bungee jumping because jump out of airplanes and have my parachute not open, how would that be? Or like the guy that just jumped from the edge of space and plummeted, how many miles did he plummet? 26 miles or something through Felix Baumgartner or something. Some people think that'd be really cool. And but I think, it would be kind of cool. Jump out of something at the edge of space and free fall all the way to the earth and just pop your parachute at the end or something. And for him, he said, that's kind of cool, but yeah, take it or leave it. That'd be kind of cool, but also not, so it doesn't matter either way. However you see your death happening, ask if that would be really cool. Or what kind of sickness, ask if you think, okay, is that really, really, let me look at that and say, do I really have to do that? Or maybe I can turn that over to the Holy Spirit too. Yeah, look at that, all of it. All of it, the whole ball of wax, look at it. And you'll probably find something. I mean, I almost went on a trip where my best friend crashed and his car got obliterated and went down a mountainside and just the whole ball of wax there as far as having just a complete, total, fatal accident is concerned to the ultimate extent. Closed coffin, etc. And I almost went along with that, but last second I said, no, what I'm here for is more important than doing that. But I guess my friend must have thought that would be very cool, and what would it be like then to be in the afterlife after that? Of course, the way we die in the afterlife, we say, oh, I just survived annihilation. Well, not really. Not because it's all symbolic. It's all hypothetical. You hypothetically survived annihilation. And then and people want to see, well, how was it like to survive dying by cancer? How is it, what would it be like to survive, go in the afterlife after getting in a fatal accident? What would it be like, blah, 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 all this kind of stuff. So examine all that stuff too. Don't be afraid to look at it. Don't be afraid. I've looked at all of it. All of it. What would it be like to be killed, to be murdered or something, be annihilated through murder? What would that be like? And I've had instances where people have invited me to have that happen. And I say, no, I don't think so. I don't think so. Almost happened to me once. I've had other situations where psychopaths have offered to murder me if I was willing to go along with it. And I decided, no. Not that, take it or leave it, but I'm going to leave it. I'm going to pass on that one. I'm going to pass on it. That's literally what happened. So don't be afraid to look at all that stuff. And some people get in some very hairy situations, where terrible things are almost happened to them. Again, the entirety of all situations that happen to us are what we saying, well, maybe this will be like surviving annihilation. I need to work on surviving annihilation. And maybe this surviving this horrible situation is what I need to do in order to be special, feel the specialness of surviving annihilation. And whatever the situation is, whatever it is, whatever all the crimes and you can talk, possibly ever come up, etc., are literally people are deciding, okay, maybe this is it. Let me do this, and let me observe that there's always an observer there, and whatever happens, and then observing an aftermath of it. What's the aftermath like? Because we're trying to find a way to survive annihilation. That's what existence is about. The good, the bad, and the ugly, we're all trying to find a way. So look at it all and ask yourself, do I really want to do this? And you may find out that you were headed towards something, and then you realize, oh my gosh, no, I don't really want to do that. I don't really need to do that. And I realize there is a way to be saved. I don't need to do this. It's all hypothetical, completely unnecessary. And I was just saved recently from that. I mean, I was literally in a situation, which I did a video on, where someone was offering to kill me. Really, really, on the spot, actually. I realized he was willing to do it. And I said, thanks, but no thanks. And it's because really of doing these videos and clarifying all this, and I felt a purpose in life, I decided, no, I've got a really strong purpose in life. I've got a really strong purpose for being here. And I'm going to keep going with this. And I turned it down. So again, thank everyone, all the viewers here, because it actually, in some way, you saved my life. Because doing all these videos and you're watching, I feel like, hey, we're moving towards the big boost here. And this is going to work. And this is important. And so I turned down this opportunity, you know, of a psychopath to die in that way. Partly because of this, partly because of it. So we do save each other's lives. We really do. We really do. I've had that experience many ways. People have saved my lives in many, many, many ways. I've had opportunities to die in so many different ways, and I've turned them all down because of something that beforehand that I decided, you know what, it's worth it to keep on going. It's worth it to keep on going. Really, there's one time back in 1997 where I felt I had nothing more to live for. Nothing interests me in the world, nothing to live for. And I feel at some point I probably would have found some way to die. And at that very day, I came across Ananda Mayama in a bookstore. I saw some CD with her chants or Sankirtana. I said, who's that? Never seen anyone look like that in my whole life. I said, I've never seen anyone like that. And actually in a dream, she had come to me in a dream several days earlier, or the day earlier, whatever, a couple days earlier. I said, who is that? And so I went in this bookstore, and I saw her picture on a CD, and then later I was walking around the bookstore, and I looked at this book, and her picture was on the book. I said, who's that? I didn't know it was the same person. And then I saw a video with a picture of her on it, and I said, who's that? I thought it was a completely different person. All three times, I was struck by saying, I've never seen anyone like that in my life. Who is that? And then I said, wait a minute. It seems like the names are all the same. I went back and I checked, and the names are all the same. I said, is that the same person? Because she looked very different in each picture. Very different. And I said, wait a minute, that can't be the same person, is it? And then I checked, and I double-checked, and I said, oh my God, this is the same person. Three times I came across this person, the same person. I thought it was a different person every time. And I said, I've got to find out who this person is, because I have never seen anyone like that in my whole life. This person is some kind of amazing. I just got this feeling like this person is amazing. Who is this? I took a video home, watched the video, and the first time I saw her, coming out of some ashram, some building, just walking slowly, and it just struck me like lightning. Never been struck by like that before in my life. I was struck like a lightning, and I said, oh my God, somebody is here in this world that is absolutely flawless. They have flawless spiritual realization. I saw immediately that she had a flawless spiritual realization. Perfect spiritual realization. Boom, it's like lightning, just like that. And then I was so interested in her life from that point on, I forgot all about dying. Really. Forgot all about it. I said, who is this? I gotta find out everything I can find out about who this is. And so I began a long, long study of her life and getting every book and every picture and making so many videos about her and completely immersed in who is this? How is it possible to be here with a flawless, perfect spiritual realization? How is it possible? It intrigued me. It was a challenge. And the challenge was so great, I forgot all about dying. So she definitely saved my life many times over. No question about it. And then she got me into this whole valuing of the world thing. She was able to help me get into that and help me work through that many, many different ways. My gosh. Many ways that would seem kind of bizarre, almost like, why in the world did I do that? You know, because she saw that if I didn't work through this, I could easily get caught up in deciding to die and not accept the vision of Christ. She saw that. So I did stuff that seemed kind of weird and kind of dangerous and not altogether acceptable to society, etc., 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 because she knew that come these times now, that if I hadn't done those things, I would be very tempted to do them, get caught up in the world, and I'd be attracted. Because again, belief, what a belief is doing right now is very tricky and nasty. The way it's recruiting, it is badass, hardball, really. And she saw it. She knew exactly how belief was going to market all this. And then she said, hey, look, why don't you do this now? So that you've already kind of said, take it or leave it, take it or leave it, take it or leave it, take it or leave it. So now I can just look at this stuff and say, take it or leave it. I'm not going to go with belief over that. Are you kidding me? I'm panning it all over the Holy Spirit. Easy. But if I hadn't have done it, no. It's a whole different story. Whole different story. So it's called fire breaking. It's called doing a controlled burn, so that when the wildfire comes, it can't jump over that controlled burn. That's what I called it. So I did a lot of stuff that was like controlled burn. That people say would never have thought I'm on some spiritual path, because they say, well, who's this knucklehead? I seem like a knucklehead, you know, really. But I was aware that I was doing it because it was a controlled burn. And I was aware there was some purpose for it in the future, that there would be some ability, application for it in the future. I was very much aware of it. And then I was able to get out of it before things got too bad. But it did get hairy at times. Things got hairy at times, I'll tell you. And I was able to get out of all the stuff. And now at this point, you know, there's no attraction to the way that belief is marketing what it's marketing. The way it's marketing specialness, the way it's marketing judgment, the way it's marketing trauma, the way it's marketing that there's that another cycle of existence, and all that stuff is really, really, really deceptive. Full on deceptive. It's the full Monty that we're being faced with in this world right now. That is not a joke. This is another fact. Don't give up. Hang in there, because you are getting hit by the full Monty right now. All the traumas, all the tragedies, all these crises, all these horrible things are happening in the world. It's belief is giving you the full dose. It's pedal to the metal for belief. Pedal to the metal. But you got an ally here. You got an ally. And you will have more allies if what I see coming, the big boost coming, as I have been promised and seen it coming. When that gets here, you're gonna really have strong allies. Strong allies, big time allies. This is big time. We're in the big time. This is big time right now. We're dealing with December 21st. Once we cross that threshold, we're in the big time. You're in the big time. We're on the center stage. It is big time. And this situation here in the world is coming from many angles. A lot of them from different places, extraterrestrial in origin, from a lot of angles. And it you're in the crucible. You're in the crucible. And I'm right here with you. Right here in the crucible with you. Because I decided, no, I'm not going to die. Because I thought it might be too tough for me. Because my responsibility seems to be so extreme, actually. And I thought, God, how in the world can I do that? What I'm being asked to do is, are you kidding? Are you kidding me? So I thought, it's too tough. I'm not going to be able to do that. It's very extreme. So, but fortunately, I've been able to get this far. And with the grace of God, I'll keep going. And I need the grace of God to keep going, because the situation is rough and tough right now. It's a wild, wild west. It's really the wild, wild west that's taking place right now. Hold on to your hats. Hold on to your hats. It's coming up. And again, tune out the news. I'm trying to give you a better story, better news story, better celebration, and ultimately a better locale. the locale, what I speak of locale is several things. One is the Holy Spirit returning existence in a blessed format to us. First of all, right here, this world in a blessed format. But also, it could also be the blessing of another locale, another realm, another planet, another place that also could take place down the road. Very possible that at some point, I believe that will take place, because the crises will get worse and worse. Ultimately, there'll be galactic type of crises, cosmic crises of a planetary nature ultimately here. So relocation will be necessary at that point, but we're not at that point yet. So the other locale could be several things. It could be having the existence returned to you in a blessed condition, so the whole world is blessed to you. And it can also mean actually relocating to a better, safer locale in this world. And the question is, well, how do you do that? I mean, who has the finances to do that? I mean, I sure don't. But the grace of God can arrange anything during these, always, and especially during these times. If you decide to go with the grace of God and go with this path, the one path of salvation that there is, and not make any exceptions, keep gravitating towards not making any exceptions. If you're willing to work on that, the grace of God is with you. Grace of God is with you, and then there's nothing within existence the grace of God cannot do. So grace of God can literally place you in a mansion, in some gated community, in a very safe locale. It can do that, even if you don't have a penny right now. Which is me, actually. Worse than that, got a lot of debt, but even with that, you can be placed anywhere. The grace of God can do anything for you. If you have that willingness to go with the big boost, it is possible. So the question of, well, how can I get to a better locale? Feasibly, as far as finances, family, all that kind of stuff, there is a way. There is a way. Like, for instance, the grace of Ananda, my mother, was working, that she was witnessing to there and being part of that. And that in situation, it arranged unbelievable stuff. Stuff that people just said, this is incredible. How could this possibly be arranged? Everything was arranged. Whatever needed to be arranged miraculously was arranged. Miraculously. But people would just say, they didn't even know how it happened. They didn't know how it happened. They did not. They said, how in the world did that happen? But it happened. So when you are in the grace of God, when you're with a genuine spirit, a big boost situation, when you're willing to resonate with reassurance, when you're willing to abide in acceptance, when you're willing to search for that which you're making an exception for, and examine your value of the world, when you're willing to get with a big boost, when you're willing to do that, go gravitate in that direction towards accepting reality as it is, then the grace of God is with you in such a large measure that whatever needs to happen for you will happen for you, whatever it is. And there's no obstacle that the grace of God cannot surmount for you. None. So don't worry about it. Don't fret about it. Don't fret about it. Just keep working on what you're working on. Just keep working at it. Just keep working at it. And I'll keep working at my role. Whatever that might be, which I'm not really clear about entirely. But it's something. Whatever it is, it is. It doesn't make any difference. Whatever it is, it is. I'm not entirely clear about what it is, really. But it's something significant in some way. You know, something that will seem to be have some significance. At least it would seem that way. But if not, fine. I still make these videos. I started out with nobody watching. I had a bunch of channels with videos nobody watched for years. Like zero views, zero. But I kept going, and now, you know, I get some views. And maybe someday I'll get a lot of views, maybe someday I'll get no views. It's all the same, whatever. It's all good. But the big boost is important, and we should look forward and say, you know what, it's likely that something going to happen that way for us. So hang in there. Have faith in the grace of God. Have faith in it. Don't get impatient. Do inventory. What is it that you're making an exception for? Find it. Find the stuff. Find it. Bring it out into the light. Look at it. Just look at it in the light. Don't hide it. Don't keep hiding it. Don't have some place, some secret stash somewhere. Everybody's got some stash somewhere, some secret stash. Bring the stash out in the open. I know, for me, I have a stash of shirts in the shed. I've been willing to give them all away in the past. I gave away so much stuff. Pragmatically, I don't feel like I want to give them away. Maybe there's some use for them at some point. But we all have a stash of some sort, secret stash of some sort, either of things or ideas on the future, of what we cherish or whatever. We want it to be special. Say, no, I want this to be special. This is going to help me survive annihilation. Nah, we don't. There will be no annihilation. So we don't need to learn how to survive annihilation. It's all a contingency plan, which is entirely unnecessary. Entirely unnecessary. 100% unnecessary. Always and forever, from the very beginning, it's been that way. And will ever be that way. Totally unnecessary. So we don't need that secret stash. We can hand it over to the Holy Spirit. Hand our secret stash over to the Holy Spirit. Here you go. Take it all. I don't want it. Take it all. I don't want even a speck of it. Take it all. Don't leave a speck of it for me. Then, that's great. All right, very great. Oh, it's gonna start hailing soon, you know that? I'm gonna get inside. This is something else. That's it, very great. It's been a pleasure making the video.